Good evening, and welcome to the Watchman's Warning.
Is you, Father.
Amen.
That's all we want. That's it.
Right.
This whole world is falling apart as we see it. And we're not going to go neck and neck in all the garbage going on, especially this time of year, every 4 years. No. No. We need Jesus. We're praying that the right man would get in office. But the way the world is set up, we know what's going to happen. We know that you have called it to be so because of the wickedness in this world. We're speaking to you out there tonight, and we're telling you to get right with God. You best get right with God. Judgment is here. It's not coming. It's here. The separation of the sheep and the goats is going on. It's time to open your eyes. Open your eyes. Open your heart. Let the Lord show you the truth. I have neighbors messaging me, telling me I need to vote a certain person in. No. No. I love Brother Tom, first off. This program isn't about elections. It's about sheep and goats. But I'm just letting you know I have friends that I've known for over 20 years telling me what to do, or I'm in sin. No. Huh. That's not what the Bible calls sin. His kingdom is not of this world. And yes, Israel asked for a king. But that did not please God, because he's supposed to be our king. God gave them what they want, and God's going to give you what you want. The wickedness of your heart is going to come out. Street preachers, you're preaching Jesus, but you're acting of the devil. No, you don't do this to the brethren over an unsaved person. A wicked snake. You don't do that.
Yeah.
You don't do that. No. You'll find out within a few months what's going on out there and who he really is. Program's not about that, but you'll find out quickly. I'm telling you, if this shot comes out and you have to take it, or you can't get into the store, like they're not letting people into stores without a mask. If you can't get in without the shot, and along with that shot comes a little tattoo thing to prove you've had the shot, don't be stupid. If that happens, you know where we are in the Bible. But if you're a goat, you won't know. If you're not staying close to him, you won't know. If you're spending more time in politics than you are in the Word of God, you're going to fall. You will not hear his voice.
No,
you can't cry repent to everybody that sins. Now listen here, you can't cry repent. Oh, but he's not a preacher. He's not the pastor. He's the president. You can't preach repent to one and not the other. Shame on you. Shame on you. Shame on you. Your eyes are being blinded. To deceive the elect if it was possible. Right. And that's what's happening.
And when they stand up and they say, this is not the mark of the beast, many will be deceived and believe.
Mm.
When they stand up and say, we have heard it said by some cults, by some far, far, far right-winger cults that this is the mark of the beast. We assure you it is not. We tell you the truth. We're the government. We care about you.
Preach.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't. They care about their own pockets. They care about their nation rather than the kingdom which you aren't supposed to belong to. We are ambassadors for Christ. We are not of this world. Our kingdom is not of this world.
Come on.
And when we put more stock in the pastor or your deacon, or your governor, your prime minister, your president, when you put more stock in another person than you do, even in the Word of God, and then you turn around and you say, but the Word of God says, then I will say, you hypocrites, you say that you have the truth, but you don't. You are a liar, just like your father the devil.
Yes.
For you who know the truth are doubly accountable, for you cannot stand before God and plead ignorance. For God will see right into the very depths of your heart and your soul, and you will have no excuse when on that day of judgment, when you stand before the Lord, when you stand before his throne, you will have no excuse.
Right.
And I never heard, I didn't believe them, because you didn't study to show yourself approved. You did not act like the Bereans did and go to the scriptures to see if what you were being taught. Oh, but my pastor told me. I don't care what your pastor tells you.
Come on, Jesus.
What does your God tell you?
Come on, Jesus.
What does your Lord and Savior, the one you profess, do you know what it means to take his name in vain? It means to claim to be a child of God and actually be a child of the devil.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Come on.
For you have taken his name vainly.
Mm-hmm. And look, you might say, well, I'm not a goat. I am a sheep. Okay. Well, Ezekiel 34:17 says, as for you, my flock, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will judge between one sheep and another.
Oh.
So you might be a sheep. That's right. But the question is, who is your shepherd?
Come on.
Amen.
You know, between the rams and the male goats. So, okay, you're not a goat, you are a sheep. But who is your shepherd?
Yes.
Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. Amen. Whose voice do you hear? Are you going to be judged against other sheep? Or are you a goat in sheep's clothing?
Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on.
And it's right there in the scripture, Ezekiel 34:17. You know,
yeah.
He's going to judge between sheep.
Right.
Which flock are you in?
Having worked on several farms, one in particular close to where we live now, had sheep and goats. Had cows and other animals, but they had sheep and goats. And the Lord was reminding me of this, I think yesterday. The difference between a sheep and a goat. And you got to realize that every parable spoke to the people of the day because they understood the farming, the gardening, the livestock keeping, building. So when Jesus spoke of the chief cornerstone, he wasn't talking about the top, he was talking about the bottom, the foundation. So when he talked about the sheep and the goats, a goat will run to you because they know you have food, you have something to provide for them. A sheep will follow you because they know you.
That's good. That's
and they,
good.
They're not following you because you have anything to offer them. They're following you because they know you.
Yes. Yes.
And that's there is good. Safety near you.
That is good. That is good.
Go ahead, and brother.
And if we're going to get into the difference between sheep and goats, for one, goats eat trash. So yep. What are you consuming? You know, are you consuming the television? Are you consuming the music that you shouldn't be listening to?
Porn.
What are you consuming?
Mm-hmm.
Goats eat trash.
Come on.
Goats are go arrogant. Goats are
go
prideful.
Eat anything.
Yeah. Yep.
Goats will eat whatever you give them.
Goats will have their head up high, where sheep are more humble. So, are you prideful? Well, then you're a goat, because goats are very arrogant. You know, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, and arrogancy,
yes,
and the evil way,
yes,
and the forward mouth do I hate, says the Lord.
Cool.
Everyone that is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord, which is a goat and not a sheep. Goats are aggressive. And doesn't Hebrews 12:14 say, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord? But goats are aggressive. They will attack you for anything.
Mm.
You know, the goat is like his father. Aggressive.
Right.
Good.
You know,
good.
Who else is aggressive?
This is good. This is good. Break it down, brothers. Break it down.
Goats constantly jump the fence. Aren't we told that narrow is the way, the narrow gate? You can't jump the fence. You can't go off course and jump the fence. But what do? Goats will jump the fence. Sheep will follow its shepherd.
Oh, yes.
Yep.
Good.
So,
you ever seen a goat throw a fit?
Yes.
This is why they're called kids. They throw an absolute fit when they don't get their own way.
Kids, I love it.
Same.
Well, which goes with goats are always in a bad mood. You know,
yep.
And doesn't the Bible tell us forbearing one another and forgiving one another?
Mm.
If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, also do ye. But goats won't do that, because goats, you can pet them, they're in a bad mood. You can do whatever you want to a goat to make it feel comfortable, but they're always in a bad mood.
And that's the other thing is you talked about having aught, or Jesus talked about having aught against your brother. If you have aught against your brother, what do? You leave your offering at the altar. But how many people put their offering down knowing that they've got something against someone else? They don't go and make peace with them, you know. And let's switch gears here for a second, and let's go over to the wheat and the tares. It's the exact same thing. Okay, there's a separation of the wheat or of the sheep and goats, but there's also going to be a separation of the wheat and the tares.
Tares don't have any nutritional value.
Tares have zero nutritional value.
I bet you goats eat them. I bet you goats would eat tares. And I bet you the sheep would rather eat the wheat.
And when it comes down to it, wheat and tares, when they're growing up, look identical. That's why in the parable, Jesus said, leave them be until the time appointed, until the time of maturity. Because once the plant starts maturing, then you can tell the difference.
Yeah, because tares don't really mature like wheat do.
They don't.
Tares don't mature at all. They're still that greeny color and everything, but wheat will grow up and turn a nice golden color.
And you'll get a nice wheat head stalk on it.
Tares don't do that. They never truly mature. They're fruit and they're... Their food would be the food in the wheat. The head of the wheat doesn't ever grow up.
It never produces fruit.
Nope.
This is good.
So, like I said, Jesus gave these parables in a way so that the people could understand it. When he was asked, why do you speak in parables? And he's like, so that the people will understand. And here we are. The devil has come along and strayed us away. You can reach more farmers nowadays with the gospel than you can city people.
Strictly by utilizing
the parables. They'll understand them because they know. So with the city people, you have to take a different approach to it.
Mm-hmm.
You can reach them with the gospel, but they're not going to really understand the parables. You know, wheat and tares. What's a tare? Well, now you have to go through it. So,
right, sheep and goats. Some people have a hard time deciphering the two because they are kind of similar. And, you know, I've watched some YouTube videos, and I will say, that one YouTube video of the screaming goat has me in stitches. But at the end of the day, it's still a goat, and there is a difference between sheep and goats.
Oh.
So, you know, city people don't quite understand the difference between the sheep and the goats. But if you actually look at them and have eyes to see, you can see the difference between them.
Oh, absolutely. And look at how many different breeds of sheep there are, right? Like there's many different breeds of sheep.
Oh, some of them are so cute.
But they all act the same.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
They're all loyal to their shepherd.
Yeah, but
okay. How many different types of goats there are? My personal favorite is actually the fainting goat. When trouble comes, they just drop dead.
Yeah.
Or seem like they drop dead. Come on now.
That is good.
Have you ever seen them, sis?
No, I never have. You need to show me that.
Just Google fainting goats. You'll love it. It's awesome.
But goats are really cute, too. But, I mean, you have these little miniature goats, which are probably my favorite.
But they're useless.
But they're basically perpetual babies.
Oh, yeah.
They can never really, they'll eat pretty much anything, but with miniature goats, you have to give them a lot more milk, and you have to give them, like, oatmeal, and they can't eat, like, cans, like, tin cans and stuff like other goats can. These are very, very sensitive, perpetual babies, and I see that a lot in the church. There's very, very overly sensitive perpetual babies. If you were to look at these little miniature goats, which are so adorable, but you can't scold a miniature goat because they'll cry and they'll whine and
you can almost give them a heart attack.
They're so overly sensitive. And you do the same within the church. You see the people and you try and give them, even gently, you try and give some of these people correction, and you try and give them something stronger than the milk.
And of course,
they get offended. Block, block, and run away. Yeah.
You hear the same thing from these miniature goats.
Wow.
And that is quite simply, it was because of religious people. And that's their excuse. It was because of religious people that I walked away from God. Well,
right.
Then your faith was in the wrong.
Right. Don't tell me that, you know, you it's because of you that I'm doing this. I've heard that so many times from so many different people. No. If that was the case, I would have walked away from the Lord a long time ago. I've had blogs made about me. All the people that have come against me. No. My faith is in Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach. I don't care what any of you out there think about me. I don't care what any of you out here think about me, my neighborhood or whatever. I could care less. I'm going to follow the Lord. Give me Jesus, okay? That's it. That song is my song. Give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. Take it. Enjoy it. I don't care two bits about it. Repent and get right with the Lord. Right. Come on now.
Because again, goats eat trash. I mean,
one
of the marks of a goat is that it'll eat almost anything.
Yeah, anything.
Much
makes
more
them
than
happy.
Just eating it, it thinks that the trash is delicious.
Yes.
There are Christians who don't even feed themselves well, spiritually speaking.
Oh, this is so good.
You know, the goats feed themselves on what is popular, what is exciting, and what has little or no eternal value.
Yes.
Often they stay at home or even go to church, you know, and follow the false prophets on TV instead of seeking good spiritual food, and they miss the point. And, you know, I mean, First Peter 2:2 tells us, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. Goats don't desire sincere milk because they're jumping the fence, eating whatever is there, which is popular. You know, they don't zero in on what is important
and what is
spiritual.
We had a friend who had a baby goat when we were on the island. His name was Bob, actually. It was cutest little thing. But you would give him food, and you would give him food, and it was good food, and you could give him junk food. He'd eat your shoe. He tried to eat my hair. It was annoying. But if you just stop paying attention to him and you stop giving him what he wanted, he'd ram you in the butt.
He'd headbutt you.
He'd throw an absolute fit if you didn't constantly give him attention.
A goat. That's what a goat. Yeah. Wow. Wow. Yeah. Constantly patty caking. Constantly, building them up, lifting them up, encouraging, commenting. I mean, come on. Yeah. Go to the Lord. You know, sometimes I get depressed. Sometimes I am lonely. And, you know, I need to go to the Lord. That's where that song hit me. And when I am alone, give me Jesus. That's who I have. That's who I am.
Right.
That's who we all have, no matter what we're going through. Come on. We got different things going on in our life. Are you a sheep or are you a goat? It's time. I'm telling you, hell is about to break loose on this earth. Even more so than ever. I don't give a rat's butt. Yeah, I said that. Who wins this election, okay? I wish Brother Tom would. I so wish we would have a God-fearing Christian, him and Andy, in the platform. I so wish that would happen. If it doesn't, and it doesn't look like it, but God can do what he wants. If Yahweh feels that there's repentance in this world and that people want change and enough people reached out and did vote for him. I'm going to say it like that because that's the truth. If somebody won, then God would hear our cry. You know, Lord, if there's six people that want you, will you forgive us? Will you help us, Lord? If there's five people, Lord, if there's four people, Lord, Father, he's looking for somebody. He's looking for a nation that will cry out to him and not the demonic, the Democrats and Republicans, because that's what they are. Hello.
Amen.
Hello. They're baby-killing, murdering, tearing apart, ripping them apart. They're murderers. What are you doing? You're fighting with the brethren. You're a goat. If you're fighting with the brethren over that, you are nothing but a goat or a little Amen. Sheep, and there's going to be a separation going on between the sheep and the sheep also, just like Brother Shane just got done reading that scripture. You better watch yourself. Watch yourself. Stop attacking the brethren. Stop attacking the brethren just because and you're idols. Come on, people.
And here's the thing. The Apostle Paul, though he called the worst, in my personal opinion, and probably not mine alone, the worst church in the New Testament. He called them saints.
Yeah, right.
Okay. He called the Corinthians saints.
Oh, boy.
And it took at least two letters. Okay. And in his first epistle to the Corinthians,
preach it.
Right there, right in the beginning, chapter 1, starting at verse 10, he says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you."
I guess they weren't, huh?
Okay, so here we are. How many years ago? How many? We're talking...
Same old.
Let's just say about 1800 years ago.
Uh-huh.
Okay. We have Paul rebuking them, telling them, don't be divided. For the body of Christ is not divided. It needs to be fitly joined together. Mm-hmm. Okay? And you go on to chapter 3 and check this out.
That's why there's so many denominations. Hello?
That's right. Yeah. He comes in chapter 3 a little while later, and he says in verse 3, 1 Corinthians 3:3, "For ye are yet carnal."
Oh, wow.
Amen. Gosh.
Good.
Yeah, because he says, has the Messiah been divided? Mm. I mean, has Jesus been divided?
Come on.
No, that's right.
Are you a Paul? Where's the division?
That's right, and that's actually...
you goats.
Yeah, and that's the next verse, Jen, is, are you... You know, he says here, "For while one saith, I am of Paul, and another, I am of Apollos, are ye not carnal?"
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
So it's and that's it reminds me of Ravenhill was talking about a church that he had pastored at, and the Lord was moving him onward, and he went and talked to one of the ladies from his congregation, an older lady, and he said, "Well, I assure you, the pastor that's replacing me is going to be, you know, just as good as I am," and she said, "Well, that's what they said about the last pastor." And that's what it is. Mm-mm, comfort.
Mm-mm. Yeah.
Goats want comfort.
Patty cake me. Joel Osteen. Joel
that's
Osteen
right.
pastors.
We don't feed have enough John goats. Wesley's gift, Benny Osteen.
Yeah.
All flock to that goat. That's what they flock to. Okay, I tell you, if Oprah Winfrey sat in the church that I was pastoring, she would walk out or run to the altar within the first 10 minutes. Okay, this is Miss Patricia talking, and you best believe it, because I would rebuke it. I would rebuke it. There'd be conviction. If this team, I love this team of Watchmen on the air with me. I love them so much because they are bold. I've known Jason and Jen for over 15 years, golly, at least 15 years, 10 years, 15 years, 10 years. It feels like
10, 15. I don't know, it's been a while.
It's a long time. And Shane came on, crap. Known him a couple of years, and he is just so on fire for the Lord. We had to ask him in. We had to. He is bold, and that's what is needed. That's what is needed. If somebody that's in sin doesn't either curse you out or run to the altar, you're not preaching right, okay? And you're patty-caking the goats.
What did I say earlier? What did I say earlier? I can't remember what we were talking about, but Jen and I were in the car, and we were talking about something. But anyways, I said, that's because they are of the world, and Jesus said, the world loves you because they love their own.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And if you are hated for my name's sake, remember, I was hated first.
We're not even of this world, because, I mean,
so why?
Somewhere in scripture it says, and I'm like I said, I'm not very good at remembering book or anything, but I think scripture says is that our freedom is in Christ. So when everybody says, well, you need to vote for this person because they'll give you this freedom, actually, my freedom's in Christ.
Hello.
You can stick me in the cell. Paul and Silas were sitting in the cell, and they were praising the Lord.
Oh, right after they were whipped. Right after they were whipped.
Come on.
Why is it about rights and freedoms and et cetera, of the world when there are people in other countries and stuff where it's illegal to be a believer?
Come on.
Like 52 countries, the Bible is illegal, and they praise the Lord anyway. And they do it anyway. It doesn't matter. You could go ahead and who cares if they shut down the church buildings? Go and stand on the street corner. John Wesley got kicked out of all of the churches.
Come on, girl, go there.
Street corner. Highways and the blockades, that's where you need it anyway.
That's right.
There are prisoners in North Korea where you could die for just having a Bible. There are prisoners in Iraq where you could just die for being a Christian who are more free than most Americans because they have Christ. For whoever he sets free is free indeed.
Completely.
So where are your freedoms at? And okay, so you're not a goat. You are a sheep. But again, who is your shepherd?
Exactly.
That's right.
And if he tells you to go, will you give him an excuse? Oh, but I'm having my hair done today. If he tells you there's somebody, like last week, Jen and Jason, they felt led to go. They did laundry. I'll let you guys say it. Go ahead and say it. They didn't come on the program with us last week because God had another plan. Come on, guys.
If anybody is listening to this now, and you listened to last week's program, I'm not going to go into my reasoning, but I just felt led by the Lord to just kind of step out from that. We are Canadian. We do have our opinion on politics, American politics, et cetera, et cetera. Anybody who's listened to us knows that. But we just felt led by the Lord. So
I've been promoting Brother Tom all over Facebook, and I'm Canadian.
I know you have, girl.
But that aside, we just felt led by the Lord to kind of step back from last week's program. And we went and did laundry.
Yeah.
Because we had the time. We were listening a little bit to the program, but the Lord had other plans. We spent
45 minutes to an hour.
45 minutes to an hour preaching and witnessing to a guy at the laundromat. And the best part about it was at least half that time was after our laundry was done.
Yeah.
We didn't just go, okay, our laundry's done, have a good one, and leave. We stayed there for an extra half an hour. I just continued preaching to this guy while he finished his laundry.
It started out talking about a picture of an RV on a community.
Anybody who knows, we live in an RV, so we love RVs.
Yeah, and we started talking to, and it just came about us traveling and preaching, and then we just gave him the gospel, and he was, the difference is the goats are ruining the fact. They're distorting the truth of Jesus.
Yes.
Because when you look at someone and he said, oh, well, my wife is raised Catholic. I grew up in a Pentecostal church, but I kind of don't really go anymore. And because they're looking at it as, you know, they want the true Jesus of the Bible. Like I was trying to tell people on Facebook, like Ken Ham and stuff. Ken Ham said, oh, well, you know, the pandemic is making people leave the church. No, your little American Jesus is making people leave the church. They're confused. The man we were talking to seemed so shocked that we were so radical for Jesus that we were willing to give up everything. To just travel across the country
to go where he leads.
And to go to all the drug addicts.
Yep, I remember. You know,
that we had enough faith to say, oh, don't worry about it, even if we don't have any money, God will provide us to get there.
I can't even count on all my fingers and all my toes twice. I can't even count how many times that we had nothing and God provided.
Because
we were faithful. Jesus told his disciples, don't even take a money purse.
Yeah.
That's right. How'd they get on the jet plane then, you know? I'm not going
there. Well, that's because my congregation is going to buy me an $85 million jet.
Come on. So, whereas, you know, I don't need money in my purse. I got my credit card. You know, I can just charge it and charge it.
Yeah, we're good. We're good.
Take up offerings.
The goats are telling people, oh, you need the tithe. You need to give money. You need to give to God. Well, actually, God wants to give to you. And he wants to give to you what you need. And anything beyond what you need is a blessing, and you should be thanking God for any blessing that you have.
And you should pass it on.
And you should pass that blessing on.
In all things, give thanks unto
all,
the Lord.
All good.
For he does give, no matter what. Right. He does mm-hmm. give, but he also takes away. Are you thanking him when he takes something away from you?
Ooh,
or are you just thanking him when you get something? You know, in all things.
And
all
that's things. That's the difference between the sheep and the goats. Mm-hmm. Are you thanking him for all things or some things?
But I lost right. my job. You know, where was God when I lost my job? I lost my health. Where was God when I lost my health? I lost my daughter in a car wreck. Where was God? Come on, people. We're not talking because we don't know, all right? We've been there.
Right.
But Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, is our source. Not man.
I just
not that $1,200 stimulus check. If it comes, fantastic. Mm-hmm. I have plans to bless somebody that needs something right now. So let it come.
Amen.
But if it doesn't come, that's my taxes anyway that we shouldn't be having to pay. That's another story altogether. You know, we should be helping each other. Jesus Christ told us we're supposed to help the people. We're supposed to, true religion is visiting the widow, okay? Feeding the poor, helping those that are in need, okay? That's what true religion is. And if you're not doing that, you got something wrong with you. If you lose what you got, I was told, somebody said something to me the other day. Oh, really? So, you know, you don't celebrate the lesser of two evils. I found it. My mind got there. The lesser of two evils. What about your job? What about if your job was telling you to do something you shouldn't do? You're not going to lose your job, are you? Don Skippy, I'm gonna. You know, they wanted me to say that the system was broke all the time. The system wasn't broke. It was never fixed, okay? I'm not going to lie to the customers. You know, I was able to get around it. You know, but I was not going to lie. I've had people tell me I need to say this or say that. No, I'm not going to say this or say that. If I lose my job, God didn't want me there anymore. Hello? I did what he wanted me to do, and then he took me out. And he has something better. And let me tell you, the way my health has been, I thank God that I'm not working right now. He knows I need to be home right now. He knows I need to be in his word more. He knows I need to be preparing with the ministry, with what's about to come on this earth. We're not supposed to put our faith in man or money. If it comes, great. And let me tell you, help me, Lord. Since I lost my job, I've had people help me with my MRI. People help me with, I never asked for nothing. All of a sudden, I go to my PayPal. You know, somebody messages me, what's your PayPal? I'm like, why? They go, just what's your PayPal? What's your address? And I knew this lady, so, you know, this sister of mine. So I gave her my address. I mean, things are coming in the mail. And coming in my PayPal, I don't ask. We never ask for nothing in ministry. You're not supposed to. You're supposed to go.
Praise
freely
y'all.
Give. You free and freely, so you freely give. And I have not wanted anything. I have food in the house, okay? If you need anything, give me an email. The Watchman on the Wall, okay? @gmail.com. If you're living in my neighborhood, I'll bring you over some stuff that I have in my freezer or on my shelf. We have enough to share, and you should have enough be able to share. You know, we're supposed to be there for the brethren. Come on.
And that's always been the thing, is how quickly people will take half a verse or half a passage. You know, they'll be like, oh, well, Jesus told us to give, so look at all that I've given. You know, at that point, you sound like a rich young ruler. All these commandments have I kept since my youth.
Well, then sell everything you have and give it to the poor. And what happened?
And if the church would step up and actually help people like they needed the help, then we wouldn't need food stamp programs.
We don't need the government
programs. We wouldn't need any of that.
That's right.
But we are to help one another. But instead, what do we have? We have goats going into a building, given 10% and looking down on those. And I've seen it with my own eyes.
Oh, yeah.
We're not letting him into this church. Oh, you want a meal? You're going to have to listen to one of our sermons and tell us what
you
think
first. Fill out this form.
Before I feed you. Mm-hmm. Before I feed you, you got to listen to this. You know, God bless you, be on your way. Oh, and the Bible mentions a lot about, you know, don't just tell somebody God bless and send them on their way without giving them water. or two.
You know, I'll and never pray th- for wait, you. Never you throw have away a problem. Stranger.
You're losing every. I'll pray for you. Yeah, I'll pray for you.
Never. And it says,
do something. It,
this reminds me.
Somebody asked you for your tunic. Give them their your cloak as well.
That's right.
Yeah.
So
do not turn away from those who wish to borrow from you.
We were traveling, heading east, when we first started doing the Lord's work traveling, and we ended up in a town. And as we always did,
and everybody told us we were crazy to sell everything except right? Patricia.
Yep. and
she's like, okay, we'll preach on the road then.
Come on, girl.
As we always did, we end up in a new town and we followed Matthew 10.
Yep.
You go into such a city and find a house that's worthy and let your peace be upon it. So we go and went to this one church. And I guess they were having some kids sleep over something or another, and parents I think they were picking up their kids after whatever.
I don't know.
And I went in and I talked to the lady and I said, is there a pastor available? And she's like, oh, we're not open today.
We're not open
to the public today.
Oh, wow. Is this a business?
And I kind of stopped. Huh? And I'm like, oh, okay. And I got back in our van and I was driving. And my mind was focused on that to the point where I drove through two stop signs.
Wow.
And Jen's like, honey, that was the second stop sign. I'm like, that's it. And I turned the van around and I went right back to that church. And I walk in and the lady looks at me and goes, yes, can I help you now? Right? Like that whole attitude. And I'm like, I'm sorry. I just been thinking on what you said. You said that you're not open to the public. And she's like, that's right. I said, so you're a business.
Oh,
and she's like, no, we're not a business. I said, well, have you not read where it says not to turn away a stranger? For you never know when you might be entertaining angels unawares.
Oh, hallelujah.
She's like, of course I've read that, like, total attitude. And this other guy comes up beside me. This is in the same town, sister, where I got physically removed from that potter's house.
Oh, my. This is the different one.
So, anyways,
I want to hear this. Come on.
Guy comes up beside me, and all I can think is, I could take him. But seriously, he comes up beside me, and he's like, can I help with something? And she looks at me and she's like, he needs something from the pastor. And I turned and looked at her. I said, I never said I needed anything. I said I wanted to talk to the pastor. I don't need anything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want anything except for a conversation. And the guy could tell that I was getting frustrated with this woman. So he takes me into his office and we had a great conversation. I think he was like, assistant pastor in training or something.
Okay.
Right. Like had a great conversation. By the way, that woman was his wife.
Oh, wow. Jezebel.
There I was rebuking his wife.
I love it.
So, well, goats are aggressive.
Come on.
Right.
Oh, goats so, are aggressive. Oh, ouch.
But
ouch.
And that's the whole thing that it comes down to is they take part of a passage. Like I said, give. Give and it'll be given unto you in good measure.
So bring me up a $2,000 gift and it'll be given unto you. God will bless you. Come on now. You know.
Right? Oh. Yes, they'll take it and then they'll record it. Yeah. They'll videotape it.
Yeah, yeah.
And they'll post it on YouTube. See how many likes. Look at how holy and righteous I am. You know, this reminds me of somebody. Who was it? Oh, right, the Pharisees wandering around, making a big show of their offering.
Mm-hmm. And like embroidered trumpets. Gowns
like
and
this,
all.
This, like, look at this great offering I'm giving. Mm. Okay? And right. In God's eyes, that offering that they were giving was nothing compared to the two mites from the poor widow woman.
Poor widow. She had everything. Yes. Yes.
So... sow your $2,000 seed to me, and it will grow. Yes.
Sow where you want to go.
Even a hundredfold, the Lord will bless you.
The Lord promised that He give us all of our needs according to His riches and glory. He provide our needs, and when by His stripes. Now hear me, people. By His stripes you are healed. That doesn't mean necessarily physically. Hello, if you look that whole thing up, if you really study that verse in the original, really study it, he's talking about your spirit. By his stripes. Yeah. He didn't go to the cross so you can have a mansion in this land and a Mercedes-Benz to ride around in and thousands of dollars in your wallet. Yahweh became flesh in the form of Jesus, okay? They're one and the same. Hello, God is a spirit who became flesh, okay? The Holy Spirit is a spirit, is God, and he became flesh. That's Jesus, okay? And it was because he went to that cross because he wanted you not to burn in the lake of fire at the end of the earth, where he cast you all in the lake of fire, those that don't repent and turn from their wickedness, okay? He didn't want that to happen. Right. It wasn't so you could physically walk. I know people that are paraplegics, and they're praising the Lord. I belong to a stroke group, and they're praising the Lord. This one man only has one finger, Brother David, that he writes with. Only one finger. And he has written how many books about the Lord? Come on. It has nothing to do with a physical healing. So stop cursing God just because you haven't been completely healed yet. Okay? Don't
just
do it.
Just think about it. Are you actually thinking that you're going to be healed to the point to where you live to be 500? You know, you're never going to get sick in this world. Joel Osteen would say, live your best life now. Well, that's not what the Bible says.
The Bible says,
blessed are those
later.
Who are persecuted for my name's sake.
Come on.
You know, that's not living your best life now. No. So you're going to pray to be healed constantly so you live to be 500? No. It's talking about you will die, for the wages of sin is death, and we are all sinful. We have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. So you are going to die.
Yeah.
So the healing and is your soul. Your whole spirit is going to either perish or you will
live forever.
Inherit the kingdom of heaven. And you're going to live forever, whether it be in heaven or hell. So, you know, God must hate me because I'm sick. No. You might be physically sick, but where are you spiritually?
I know what I did to my body when I was a sinner. I deserve every single thing that I've got right now. I'm reaping what I sowed.
Amen.
And the Lord gives me, it's funny though, the Lord will give me enough room that I'm able to come on here, even though I've been on the heating pad all day, okay? I've been resting all day. I've been in tears most of the time because I'm in pain. But he still has given me enough to get up, come out here and sit in this old chair at my desk and preach. Okay? That's what I pray. Lord, let me die preaching. Okay? No matter what. Maybe you might not heal me in this life. If you do, fantastic. But if you don't, give me the strength, the wherewithal to preach the gospel. That's what
give
it's all about.
Give me North America ere I die.
Come on.
That's right.
Come on.
You know, the difference between the sheep and the goats is it's very, very easy, at least in the Western world, like North America. It's very, very easy. So if the sheep are trying to do everything the Lord says, they trust in the Lord, they don't care if they're persecuted, they don't care what anybody says about them, they're going to speak the truth no matter what. And if all the sheep got together and if all the believers in North America got together, there wouldn't be homelessness. There wouldn't be racism. There wouldn't be climate change. There wouldn't be, you know, all these faith preachers going, oh, well, we can heal you. Well, you know what? Go into the hospital and start healing people. Stop charging $500 ticket.
Come on.
You want to
heal
somebody?
Come on.
There's a whole bunch of sick little children with cancer. You walk into that hospital, lay hands, because there's power behind the gospel. There's power in the word of the Lord.
If you are truly a faith healer and what you are doing comes from the Lord, truly, then you won't be doing it on video and you'll be doing it where the sick are.
Yeah,
Jesus said, whatever you do to the least of these, and the least of these, he even specified, I was sick and you didn't come visit me.
Yeah, and see, Peter, the sick people would go even to be in Peter's shadow, because behind the words of the gospel, behind the word of God, what Paul was preaching, what Peter was preaching, Even that woman who just touched Jesus' cloak, yes. She got healed.
Hem of his garment.
And those are the true sheep. Those are the ones that are going, okay, well, I'm going to give you the gospel, and God's going to do miracles through that.
At 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Better come at 3 in the afternoon. He's going to be here for 3 hours, and then we're going to go out to eat.
Yeah. So
make sure you get here on time.
And it drives me crazy.
Look at the shadow of Peter. I mean, what did the shadow of Peter do with that kind of faith in the Holy Spirit?
Yep.
Well, and it drives me
crazy with the whole church. You call them up, and they're only open for certain hours and everything. Are you kidding? Yeah. Like, the Holy Spirit only gets so much time.
Only businesses have hours of operation.
Exactly, and it drives me crazy. And goats don't care. The goats are just saying, oh, the goats are being deceived, thinking that the earth is millions of years old. That's why climate change isn't real, because the earth is billions of years old. Well, you know what? Actually, climate change proves that the earth is what the Bible says it is.
Come on.
And that we are destroying it. And as a believer, you're supposed to be protecting it. You're supposed to be feeding the homeless. You're supposed to be going to the prisons and getting those people and pulling them out of the pit and out of the mire that the devil has stuck them in. But you look down your noses as the drug addict that's walking around. And so what if he peed in the street? You don't exactly have a public bathroom that you're giving them to pee in. And you got to go when you got to go. And you're not telling them how to break free of that. And they're telling me, you know, oh, well, if you're a Christian, you wouldn't be sick and God will provide you healing. Well, you know what? He did.
That's right.
He provided
a test. And the dog even agrees.
He provided money for a test for me. He provided the test to be positive. So that I didn't even know I had since I was a teenager, and now it can be cured.
That's right. And he'll provide the money for the medicine, the herbs that you need. He will.
Oh, yeah. I'm not worried about that.
Mm-hmm.
God always does. It's probably growing in the woods somewhere. That's just have to
find
it.
There you go. I love it.
I think one of them's garlic extract or something. And
I know the lamb that I follow is led to the slaughter.
Sacrament
water. Where was his faith? Yeah. But where was his faith? Come on.
The unblemished lamb that we follow was led to the slaughter. And he even said, the world hated me. So why is it going to love us?
That's right.
Come on, let's hear the Ravenhill quote. Come on, somebody. Why do we expect better treatment from this rotten world than Jesus got?
I like it.
Amen.
I like it. That's right. That's right.
So,
that's right.
So
all his disciples, right?
Yep. So let's discuss something. I made a comment in Messenger earlier about something the Lord showed me the other night. So I was laying in bed, going to sleep. I think it was Tuesday night. I was going to sleep, and the Lord showed me something. And it's something that we've been misnaming, all of us. I can't speak for Brother Shane, but we've been misnaming for years. What do you, sister, I'm going to ask you, what do you call the Catholic Church?
The harlot, but it's really the Jews, because he called the Jews the harlot. But I call the Catholic Church. I call the Pope. I call the Pope the false prophet. That's who I call him. But he's the mother. That's the mother of all. Go ahead.
There it is.
The mother.
Go ahead.
Oh, the Catholic, the mother of all religions, basically.
The mother of all harlots, right?
Yes.
Okay. Well, here's what the Lord showed me. The Catholic Church is not the mother of all harlots. Now, check this out. Okay. Now, this is something I've been calling the Catholic Church for years, too.
Go ahead.
But he showed me this. Okay. Now I'm going to try and break this down as simply and as efficiently as possible. Mm-hmm. Okay. In the body of Christ, we have, within the actual body of Christ, we have Baptists. We have Pentecostals, we have Methodists, et cetera, et cetera. I really don't care what denomination you belong to.
Come on.
I believe that God has his people even in the Catholic Church.
Uh-huh.
Because it says in Revelation, come out of her, my people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's speaking of the harlot. The Catholic Church is the head of the harlot church system.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So we've got arms and legs, Pentecostals and Baptists, and excuse me, let me rephrase that. The Pentecostal church system, the Baptist church system, the Anglican church system, and et cetera, et cetera.
Yes.
And why it's the Catholic Church is the head is because that was the start.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now pay close attention. Tithes and offerings are mandatory. That stems from the Catholic Church.
That's right.
Worshipping on Sunday.
Instead of the Sabbath, Saturday. That's right.
That stems from the Catholic Church.
That's right.
Okay. And the Lord was speaking to me, and he was going through the whole body, the arms, the legs, the lungs, the stomach, the feet, the fingers, the toes, the hands. And I said, but what about the heart? And he said, there is no heart.
Ooh, ouch. Wow.
So what we see is a correlation between the body of Christ, where Christ is the head,
mm-hmm.
and the body of church, small c,
mm-hmm.
the body of church, which Catholic Church is the head.
The body of buildings, basically, yeah. Yeah.
So that is actually the body of the harlot.
I love it.
And a harlot is one who claims to be married to someone but is committing adultery.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
And the church claims to be married to Christ, starting from the head, the Catholic Church, right down to the toes, the Methodists, Baptists, whoever.
Like, mm-hmm. yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay?
Right.
But they're married to the world.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Or the beast system. In Revelation, right. it talks about the harlot riding the beast.
Mm-hmm.
The church committing adultery while riding the beast.
That's right.
And Jesus says, mm-hmm. come out of her, my people.
Right. I mean, because let's face it, the Protestants, even though they, you know, start with Martin Luther, nailed the 99 thesis to the door, they never really separated from the Catholic Church, if you stop and think about it.
That's right.
Nope.
That's so right. Even your Protestants are still embedded.
All
in
of them, every religion.
The Catholic Church.
Mm-hmm. But we don't have the idols and well, we don't pray to the saints and.
The thing is the Roman Catholic Church has a hierarchy. The Protestant Church has a hierarchy. The government has a hierarchy. If you look at it, the early church didn't have a hierarchy.
Nope.
There were apostles that people weighed things that they and they listened to the apostles' teaching. There were elders and pastors, but they all shared, and because Jesus said, "You are a servant," right?
And there's
no hierarchy.
No.
You know, like whether or not I'm not going to call myself pastor so and so or teacher so and so or
that's a calling, not a job title.
It's not a job title. It's just there mm-hmm. and. You know, basically, the only thing that was in the early church, it was the older teaching the younger. So when we were really born again and we started coming out of the church system, we met you, Patricia, and you, as the older than us, taught us the truth. Whether we disliked it or not, which we did 90% of the time.
That's okay. That's
and then
okay.
we blocked Patricia for a few weeks and then we come back on and go, oh, well, we were reading scripture and we were right.
God was right, not me. Don't give me no glory. Blah blah blah.
See, and the other
word is right.
Let's talk about deacons. Let's talk about deacons. Did you listen to that song, sister? Deacon possessed?
Yes. I should.
Yeah. So let's discuss deacons for a moment here, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, deacons are a biblical ministry.
Yes.
Yeah, position in the body of Christ.
Stephen was a deacon.
Mm-hmm. Okay, he got stoned, but a deacon.
And we're not talking about high.
That's right. A deacon in modern Christianity is a position that is held for 2 years
by unborn again people.
By we're not even going to get into that yet. Yeah. It's a position that's held for 2 years. Okay? In the early church, a deacon was for life. So now, in modern, that is life.
You get voted out, if you're preaching too harsh, you're out of here.
In modern Christianity, it's seen as a stepping stone to a higher position. Look at the Catholic Church. You start off as a priest, you work towards becoming a bishop, and then an archbishop, and into the diocese, and into the et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And God willing, the last two years of your life, you might be pope.
Poop. Yeah.
And let's not forget, okay, when it comes to, the Protestants protested and then were murdered by the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church has a higher death rate than almost any civilization out there, okay? So the Protestants were being put to death. But then what did the Protestants end up doing? Just like their mother, they put the Baptist to death. Well, here's your third baptism, because, the Catholic Church, and then you had your, we're going to baptize babies. Baptism, I think it's, it's what it's called. And so now you got your Anabaptists, your Mennonites, your Puritans, your, Baptists, who actually read the Bible and got baptized with at the right age.
And they were able to decide.
So what did the Protestants do? Mm-hmm. The Protestants put them to death, just like their mother put them to death.
It's just a vicious cycle. Favorite people, and he put more people to death. He was so strict in his legal rules because he was a lawyer, and then he was founding on the Bible and all that stuff, and Jesus in Geneva, and he was so strictly moral that they had curfews, and anybody that broke any of Calvin's rules, they were put to death. And he was a Protestant. He was one of the apparently founding fathers of the faith.
And
I don't consider him a founding father. I consider Polycarp one of the founding fathers of the faith.
So here's the here's the thing that we look at. Jason Bellard did a song, and it was the first song I ever heard him do.
So anointed.
And it was, when did the church become a business? And it became a business when it got legalized. It became a business when it became the state religion. It became a business when it became about tithes, offerings, and butts in the seat, rather than souls saved from the pits of hell.
It's pretty serious, though, that you can pretty well know that the sheep that actually listen to the Lord and listen to Jesus and stuff, their only desire is for what he wants, what he says, and they will not go against what he says. And no matter how many people say, but the goats will compromise to get what they want.
Mm-hmm. They'll compromise everything to get what they want.
Doesn't matter. What do goats do? Goats jump fences.
Yeah.
Ouch.
So basically,
So
you have people saying, the people within the church saying, you got to go with the culture. You have to be more relevant. So, we're going to say that homosexuals are children of God. Excuse me? When did Jesus ever say that? All people are saved by God, but not everybody belong. Like Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. Not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of God. Those who only do the will of my Father will enter. So those who are doing any sort of sexual sin, and I'm not going to pick on homosexuals or otherwise, I'm going to pick on anybody who's doing a sexual sin, anybody who's, even if you're married, if you're listening to your preacher that you idolize that's saying, having a Christian should have strip poles in their bedroom,
that's
a sexual sin.
Come on.
You're not listening to
Paula
the Lord.
White says you can,
your idol.
Paula White says you can watch porn with your husband. Hello. She's Trump's high holy one that prays over him, the anointed
spiritual
one.
Advisor.
Paula White says, listen, guys out there, Paula White says you can watch porn with your husband. She said it on the platform right next to her husband. Good pick, Trump.
But the worst thing, Paula White said, which should prove to Christians. The worst thing that Paula White said is, Paula White said, whoever tells you to deny yourself is of the devil.
Yes, she said that too.
What did Jesus Christ tell us? What did Jesus tell us to do?
Deny yourself.
We are to deny ourselves.
Come on.
And this is the problem.
Paula White blasphemed the Holy Spirit, and this is Donald Trump's high spiritual advisor.
Yes.
And this is the problem. Look at these modern preachers. The quote you just gave from Paula White, okay? And then you've got, what's his name, Joseph Prince, said that we don't need to repent, we need to do it God's way.
He's also on the team. Maybe that's where Trump got it from. Because Trump doesn't think he needs to repent either. But he just got done saying, you know, Sister Sienna just said on Facebook, he just got done saying that he's non-denominational now. He was never a Christian. He's not born again. Right. He has never repented. Okay. He's going to burn in the lake of fire, okay?
You know, this is the modern preachers. I call them modern preachers. There are some current preachers that are still alive that are still biblically sound.
Yeah, because for some reason, God won't let Winky Prattney die.
Yeah, God won't let Winky Prattney die, but anyway.
He's still going.
But these modern preachers are preaching heresies and creating goats. That's what they're doing. They're creating goats. You got Mark Driscoll, who, I don't know how many years ago, more than a few, said, and I watched this video probably 10 years ago, and he said, I am a cessationist. However, I see things that only the Spirit can show, and he's talking about spiritual gifts, flip-flopping. It's like, make up your mind. Are you a cessationist or are you not? Okay, never mind the fact that he said that you can use sex toys and he was selling them on his website at the same time. Okay, these are heresies that appeal to the flesh, and that's what it is. If you're a goat and it appeals to your flesh, you're gonna like it.
That's
but if it causes you to doubt your flesh, if it makes you angry, okay, that means okay, well what did what's his name there, the funny comedian, put a helmet on.
Brad Stein
said, the truth is supposed to offend you.
Yeah.
That's how you know you don't have it.
Christian comedian. I love him. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's...
He's not very politically correct.
I love it.
And he said the same thing, and I agree with him. He said political correctness needs to die.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It needs to die.
It does.
Okay? There's just too much.
But if you look at the... And the way things are going now you can tell the sheep, because look at Daniel. Like, I love going to Daniel. It's like, I can see nowadays in Daniel, like, so much. That's why I go to Daniel all the time. So, even the children of Israel, it didn't say in Daniel that the children of Israel refused to bow down to the golden statue of Nebuchadnezzar when the bell rang. It was that Daniel... didn't, and his three...
Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego.
They're the only ones. So there's only... The sheep will not bow down to any king but their own. And that is Jesus. Jesus is the only king. He's the King of the Kings. He's the Lord of the Lords. And I see...
Come on.
I see the golden statue up in America and in Canada. Like, our prime minister is absolutely worshipped by everybody. You're the best even worldly people are saying you're the best prime minister in the world. And the worship of Trump is just, even in Canada, is outrageous. And I see that golden statue. And at the bell, as soon as the newscast comes on, everybody bows down to their idol. But there are the sheep that are going, yep, I ain't doing it.
Brother Shane, get in the chat room, Brother Shane.
I only pray, you know, I don't care if it's illegal. I don't care if I'm throwing in the den of lions. Every day I'm going to go and I'm going to look towards the east and I'm going to pray.
That's right.
And I'm going to pray to the right God, and I'm going to pray. I don't want an American Jesus. There's enough Jesuses in this world, and I don't want the American Jesus either. I want the biblical Jesus that will give me crap when I'm doing something wrong.
That's right.
I want the Holy Spirit to convict me and say, what are you doing, Jen? You know, even if it has, you know, my unsaved son coming up to me telling me that, you know, like I asked my son for a belated birthday present, right? Because I don't really like to celebrate my birthday because it also happens to be my youngest son's birthday. So I'm just not ready to celebrate. But they bought me a belated birthday present, and I told them I wanted a Geneva Bible. And my unbelieving son, I keep praying for him, guys, because they're getting reached.
Geneva but, and King James, the best. Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, he refused to buy me the Bible, not because it was too expensive, because he spent way more on my cookbooks, but because he believes that the Bible should be free.
Those are his words.
Those are his words. He said, I could not bring myself to pay for a Bible unless it's like made out of pure gold because the Bible is supposed to be free.
Well, it is. It is free on and Esau. Let me push Esau. Go to Esau. You can get, I got the Geneva Bible on my Esau. I'm looking right at it right there.
Yeah.
Amen. Same here, sister.
Uh-huh.
Hey, but I will say, again, you might, okay, so, you know, and again, I know I'm kind of going against, you know, this whole thing, you know, sheep and goats. So you might not be a goat. You're a sheep. Okay. But again, who is your shepherd? Let's not forget what Scripture says, people. And please, 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 please hear me on this one. Many will come to me and say, Lord, Lord. Many. That means a lot of people. Okay. Many will come to me in that day. And what is Yeshua going to say? Depart from me. Few. There's few. There's a remnant. Are you in that remnant? Where is your heart right now, people? Is it in politics? Is it in this world? Where is your treasure stored? Did you spend everything to buy that field with the treasure in it? And I'm not talking about did you spend all your worldly stuff. What have you sold? Have you given yourself up to get that plot of land that the treasure is in? Like the parable says, you know, I bought that land because the treasure's there. Many will come to me in that day.
But haven't we prophesied in your name? That's a sheep. And cast out devils in your name? And in thy name done wonderful works?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And then I will profess them. This is Matthew 7, 22 and 23. Then I will profess to them, and it's in the red, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. That is the worst thing any believer, I don't even call myself a Christian because there's so many flakes and fakes out there, but any believer can say, depart from me? I never want to hear those words.
Ever.
After all that we've been through, after all that I've done that I was delivered from, after every single thing I walked, I would never, my goodness, I can't imagine. I don't care if I'm mocked, ridiculed, laughed at, belittled. I don't care what they do to me. I'm going to serve you, Lord. Tell him. Tell him right now, whoever you are. I'm going to serve you, Lord, no matter what. Nobody's more important than you, Father. Nobody. Because if you think you're going to go out there and preach the gospel, but he is not your Lord. You have not done everything you have not built your house on the rock. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken unto him a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended.
Yes.
And the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house.
Yes.
Matthew 7:25 were in, and it fell not, for it was founded upon the rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine, and doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand, and the rains descended, and the floods came. They're coming. This year they're coming. 2021 they're coming. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it.
That's
right.
And somebody needs to hear this. Someone out there right now needs to hear this. You've got to stop putting faith in everything and just start putting your faith in Yeshua, the King. Why do we need presidents, prime ministers, kings, queens? We have Yeshua. That's the only thing that we need.
Right.
You know, we don't need anything else. And if we all lived like that, then it would be, you know, if my people would repent and turn to me, he will heal us.
Yes.
It's not in casting a ballot. It's not in, and this isn't a USA, Canada, Germany thing. This is a whole world thing.
Yes, the whole world.
And this is...
It's a whole world thing.
People and this is the problem is what God, what we do for God, okay? We do to honor him. We do to be obedient to him. He called us to travel across the country. That's on him, not us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Right. If it was up to us, we would have stayed in our comfort. Honestly,
yeah,
we really would have.
I was happy being around my granddaughter.
Right. Uh-huh. So we did. But the problem that we have is that whole bragging and boasting. Look at what I've done. Look at how much I've prophesied. Look at the people I've healed. Look at all this stuff. And they say that it's in the name of the Lord. Okay? But Jesus said, you've done all these things, but I don't know who you are.
Well, he said, you know, why be like the Pharisees who love to, you know, stand along the street corners of the synagogues and, you know, show that they've been fasting and they scar their face or they pray. No, he said, go into your closet and pray in secret. And what, you know, your father tells you in secret, you'll be, you know, when you do your alms, he said, do it in secret. And your father and who sees in secret will reward you openly. And, you know, and then you have these people that are so, like I said, they seem so more concerned about their free, you know, worldly freedoms and rights. They actually, you know, complain about wearing a stupid mask into a grocery store, whatever. I don't know. I don't care one way or the other if you want to wear a mask or not. It's not my problem. But, you know, there's worse things coming. Read the book of Revelation. We are in the end times. This is, you know, God is separating the sheep and the goats. The tribulation is coming. And not once in the book of Revelation, not once in the early church, did you hear anybody murmur and complain about their rights? I mean, for crying out loud, Rome used to use the early church Christians as human torches all the time. And nobody, you know, they didn't say anything. It was painful, I'm sure. And they were in tears to the Lord, I'm sure. But, you know, you're complaining on whether or not you have to wear a mask into a store. But there are worse biblical pestilence coming, you know, than some stupid common cold, well, steroid common cold or whatever. We are in the book of Revelations, and you want the mark of God on your forehead,
not
the mark of the beast. You want to know that when all these pestilence and all this stuff will not come near you because you have the mark of God on you, that the book of Revelations talks about. When the pestilence come, when the fire from heaven comes. When I was reading the book of Revelations, I kind of realized that it's similar to the book of Exodus. I noticed it's kind of the similar plagues of, like, the plagues of Egypt. You know, like, I'm not a big, you know, theologian of the Revelation, but what I noticed, though, is that the only crying out that happened was of the saints who had were martyred for the faith, and they said, when, O Lord, is my blood going to be avenged? That's the only, you know, crying out I heard. The other early church that was, or the other believers in the book of Revelations that were on the earth that was going through the tribulation and stuff, all they did was praise the Lord, and yet everybody's complaining about their worldly rights being, what do you expect? Your government and your elite and your people that are running things, they're of their father, the devil. Are you expecting them to care one lick about you? You need to turn to Jesus. You need to turn to God. And you need to rely on him to take care of you, because he's the only one that will. He's the only one that cares about you enough to die on a cross and have the most brutal death ever.
So
that you can be saved.
Thank
he's
you,
the only one.
Right.
Thank you, Brother Will. And thank you, Brother John, Doughboy Biscuit. They appreciate us teaching the truth. Praise the Lord. Give him the glory. We have nothing. What else will we do? We have to preach what thus saith the Lord. If it's not in Scripture, you ain't going to hear it up in here. No. Mm-mm.
Speaking of which, let's discuss the state of the churches.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, this is gonna be fun, you know. And I'm gonna discuss.
Hold on one second, brother. I gotta interject this wine scripture in here real quick.
All right, hit me.
It's only gonna be just a second. So
time's
you're
up.
You're either a slave to sin, or you are a slave to God. But
that's right.
The nice thing is, like John 15:15 tells us, no longer do I call you servant. For a servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all teachings which I heard from my Father, I have made known to you.
Amen. We are
servants and slaves to God, but here's the difference. God loves us so much, he calls us friends.
Yes.
Point that no love, you know, I mean, there's no greater love than he who lays down his life for us and who laid down his life for us. So why aren't we following him? We can follow everything in this world, but it's not this world. We can talk USA, Canada, Germany, whatever.
That's right.
But at the end of the day, no longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing, and God has let us know everything. You just got... Sister Patricia, I thank you so much. You know, we was talking so much. I've been listening. You know, I can't always read because I drive a lot during the day, but I have been listening to the audio Bibles.
Praise God. You have
brought me back into that.
Thank you, God, Lord.
Because I'm back into the Word of God, just listening to it over and over and over again. And it's like, wow. You get out of it for a month. You forget that which you have heard and read.
Yes. We have to stay in the
Just
Word.
Just like that.
We have to stay in the Word.
We know what his plan is. If we abide in him.
That's right.
Faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the Word.
By the Word.
If you're not in the Word, you don't know. And you know what? You could be a sheep, you could be a goat, but again,
and I need to interject one thing, and I know, Brother Jason, you're going to bring that teaching. This is for somebody right now. This is for somebody. It's only going to be a couple of minutes. We have all night. We can be on the air. We don't care. But this is for somebody. This is something that I posted that I got from somebody on Facebook. It says, every once in a while, this is about sheep, every once in a while, a baby sheep, will give birth to a lamb and reject it. Are you one of those lambs? Have you been rejected by the world? Good. Have you been rejected by everyone around you? I got some good news for you. Let me read this to you. If the lamb is returned to the ewe, even the mother may even kick the poor animal away. And once a ewe rejects one of her lambs, she never changes her mind. And these little lambs, just think about that. These little lambs will hang their heads so low. Don't make me cry. So low. It looks like something is wrong with its neck because their spirit is broken. Is that you? Listen to me tonight. Their spirit is broken. These lambs are called bummer lambs. You love the Lord, and you've been rejected so much, and you feel like you've got nothing and no one. But listen, unless the shepherd intervenes, that lambs will die, rejected and alone. So do you know what that shepherd does? He takes that rejected little one into his home, hand feeds it, keeps it warm by the fire, and he will wrap it up with blankets and hold it to his chest so the bummer can hear his heartbeat. And once the lamb is strong enough, the shepherd will place it back in the field with the rest of the flock. But that sheep never forgets how the shepherd cared for him when his mother rejected him. And when that shepherd calls for the flock, guess who runs to him first? That's right, the bummer sheep. He knows his voice intimately. It is not that the bummer lamb is loved more. It just knows intimately the one who loves it. So many of us bummer lambs rejected and broken. But he, Yeshua, or Jesus, is the good shepherd. He cares for our every need and holds us close to his heart so we can hear his heartbeat. We may be broken, Amen. But we are deeply loved by the shepherd. If that's you, you love the Lord, and everybody thinks you're a flake, maybe. Or maybe your family has rejected you. Maybe your husband or your wife has walked out on you. Stand, because the shepherd knows you. The shepherd loves you, and he's calling you to himself tonight. Yes. He's reminding you that Amen. He loves you. Run to him. Don't right. run back to drugs.
Preach.
Don't run back to porn. Don't run back to booze. Yes. Don't run back to anything that is not of him. Don't. Stand in him. Get into his word.
Yes.
Put on the praise music. Stay in his glory. Separate yourself. It's a good thing they left. It's a good thing because they're going to distract you. They're going to distract you from what God wants you to do. Zone in Amen. On just the word of God, and he will bring you out. You're not a bum a lamb.
Right.
You're his
yes.
special well, sheep. I'm done.
Because my right. sheep Thank hear you, my voice, and he knows us.
Thank you, Lord.
So before my husband, before my husband reads the scripture, because this is going to go, you know, you're looking, you know, my brothers and sisters out there listening, you're looking at all these shepherds, you know, whatever famous shepherd they're out there, or you call Trump a shepherd, like I've heard Facebook people say Trump is a shepherd of the American people or whatever, but he's not the good shepherd. There's only one good shepherd.
Yes.
You know, the state of the church is in the state of the church the way it's in because yes. they're not following the good shepherd.
That's right.
There's only one.
That's right.
Only one, and he is Yeshua. He is the Messiah. He is the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. He is the Lamb of God.
He's Yahweh.
Yahweh.
He
Yahweh.
Is
the God Go ahead, of creation.
Scripture.
I am that
God
I am.
In the flesh.
I am that I am. That's what Yahweh means.
Amen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead,
so,
read the scripture.
People wonder, so many lost people wonder why the if there's such a good God out there and he's such so good and so righteous and stuff, why is there so much evil in the world? Well, let me explain to you why. The state of the world reflects the state of the church.
We'll have more influence
on them. Okay. If you have, how is it put? A dead preacher will preach a dead sermon to a dead congregation. Quite simply it.
Amen.
You want to know what the state of the church, Amen. Or excuse me, what the state of the church is, mm-hmm. is? Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 1. And I'm going to read, I don't know how many verses, but I'm going to start at verse 11.
Okay, I'm there.
Isaiah 1:11. Uh-huh. 1:1:1. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, saith the Lord? I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs, or of he goats. When you come to appear before me, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts? Bring no more vain oblations, or for those who don't know, offerings. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with. It is iniquity. Even the solemn meeting, your new moons and your, pay attention, mm-hmm. your new moons and your appointed feasts.
Like your silly That's little right. pagan,
okay. Okay.
not his
see,
appointed
feasts,
not his.
See that there?
That
he says your.
Ours, yes.
He doesn't say my feast.
Come on, come
he doesn't
on.
Doesn't say the feasts of the Lord. He says your feasts, my soul hates. They are a trouble unto me, and I am weary to bear them. Can anything weary the Lord? Apparently. But I don't think that word weary means tired. But I digress. Well, I'm not going to get into that.
Right, right.
Check this out. Verse 15. And when ye spread forth your hands, I will hide mine eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Wash you, make you clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow.
And that,
come now.
That word weary, means disgusted.
There you go.
Go ahead.
Come now, verse 18, and let us reason together, saith the Lord.
Let us reason together. That's an important verse. Let us reason together. Although you can't reason with God.
But you could. Have to agree with him.
Right, exactly.
I'm just saying.
The one person
No, I'm just saying that is a very important verse. Let us reason together.
Like
Abraham did. If there's 10 in that city, spare them. Let us reason together.
That's good.
It says, continuing on, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow.
Thank you, Lord.
Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Wait for it. I gotta look here. We gotta get closer. Small print. It's a period, so that ends a thought. But in my opinion, I think that should be a comma. What do you think?
Yeah, comma.
Because we go on, if ye be willing and obedient.
Yes.
You shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it.
If I will be as wool, doesn't that mean I will be a sheep?
not sheep.
Hey, well, let's go back to Isaiah 1. You brought us to Isaiah, but let's get some pretext to this, okay? Where it says, hear, O heavens, and listen, O earth, for Yahweh has spoken. I have reared and brought up children. But they is us right now. We have transgressed against him. An ox knows its owner, and a donkey its master's crib. Israel does not know. My people have not understood. And, Israel. Okay, let's not get into the whole replacement theology and stuff like that. We are Israel. If you read Romans, where it says that we have been grafted in. Mm-hmm. We are Israel.
Jew and Gentile. Mm-hmm.
So this speaks to us because modern day Christianity is Israel. Nobody's been replaced.
It's not Israel. It's always Israel.
Right.
Sorry, brother. I'm going to interject here for one moment.
It's not a replacement theology.
It's a continuation.
Yes.
Exactly. And alas, sinning nation, which is the whole world, I can't say it's the United States, although it is the United States, it's Canada, it's Mexico, it's China, it's Russia, okay? Alas, the sinning nation, a people loaded with crookedness, a seed of evildoers, sons acting corruptly, they have forsaken Yahweh. We have forsaken Yahweh, and we wonder why the wrath of Yahweh is upon us.
Come on.
Because we have forsaken Yahweh. They have provoked the set apart one of Israel. We went backwards. We haven't gone forwards. We have gone backwards. Why should you be stricken anymore? You continue in apostasy.
That's right.
The world has continued in apostasy.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
All the head is sick and all the heart faints. From the sole of the foot to the head, there is no soundness in it. There's no soundness in this world anymore. You look around, and what is it? It's utter chaos, confusion. Because, again, there's no soundness in it. Wounds and bruises and open sores, they have not been closed or bound up and soothed with ointment. Why? Because we won't go to the master physician, Yeshua HaMashiach, who is the ultimate healer. Our land is laid waste. This whole world, if you look around, the whole world is laid waste. Your cities are burned. Look around.
Yes, I mean,
the West Coast is on fire. I mean, come on. This is prophecy, people. Mm-hmm. Your land is laid waste. Your cities are burned with fire. Mm-hmm. Strangers devour your land.
Come on.
There are Chinese people in Canadian towns waiting to take the United States out. Uh-huh. Again, I'm not trying to make it
about the USA. That's right. They're sleepers.
You know what? There's, you know, we got, like, troops everywhere.
That's right.
Strangers devour your land and press it.
We have the Chinese buying our land to destroy it. That's what we have. That's where our pipelines and our forestry and stuff, it's all owned by China. All of them. They're all Chinese companies, and they're buying our land and devouring it.
And Yahweh opposed had left to us a small remnant.
A small.
We have become. Right. So there is a small remnant. Are you going to listen to that small remnant? Are you going to listen? What sheep are you? Are you a sheep or are you a goat? And if you're a sheep, again, I keep saying this, who is your shepherd? Mm.
Years ago, I want to recount something here, and it comes with a scripture. Years ago, before we started on our journey heading east, this is before WTVO radio. This is before I joined Patricia on the air. We started traveling, and
you were on the radio. You were on the radio with Patricia.
Before. I think I called in once or twice, just to kind of give an opinion there before we headed out. that was my taste of.
I used to listen to the show like two years before we left.
So
that's when I was on Blog Talk.
That's right.
Yep.
Because Patricia kept saying, why are you not out there preaching the gospel? And then Jason read that scripture.
Here's where we're going. There is a Christian, I use the term Christian.
Loosely.
I actually won't say loosely because I can't really say.
Okay.
Lecrae is a Christian rapper. The song I was listening to was some of his earlier work before he got into doing songs with, like, Lil Wayne and all the worldly people. Anyways,
he's completely gone.
All that aside,
he needs to come back, go after him, Father. Bring him back. Absolutely. Bring him back, Father. Whatever you got
to
do.
So the song I was listening to is called "Send Me," and it's based out of Isaiah chapter 6.
Patricia did a show called "Send Me."
Right. I've probably done a couple shows called "Send Me." I think "Send Me" is a good message. So
That might be a good one next week.
Right. So I was singing this song, "Send Me, I'll Go," and I was reading the passage, and then the Lord said, "Fine, I will." So He sent us, and we were obedient to listen. That's what it comes down to, is obedience.
I argued,
but yeah, of course.
Until I heard that message that said "Send Me," that Patricia was doing, I argued for 2 weeks with Jason. I'm like, I'm not leaving my granddaughter and my children. And
I'm sorry.
Forget this.
2 weeks later, she comes up to me and goes, "Okay, honey, here's what I think we should do." And I'm like, "All right, I'm listening." Okay, wait, backtrack. I came to her and I said, "Honey, I think I know what we need to do." And she's like, "What's that?" I said, "I think we need to sell everything we own, get a camper van, travel across the country, preach the gospel, and do the Lord's work." She's like, "Are you nuts?"
Yeah.
2 weeks later, she comes up to me
because
and goes,
"I listened to that show that Send Me," and I was like,
2 weeks later, she comes up to me and goes, "Okay, honey, I think we know what we need to do." And I'm like, "What's that?" She's like, "We need to sell everything we own, buy a camper van, travel across the country, preach the gospel, and do the Lord's work."
Talk about serious. I got, you know, because I was listening to Patricia's preaching, and then I went to prayer about it, and I said, "Okay, Lord, I got all this confirmation. What do you have to say?" And I got a serious spiritual spanking is what I got.
Ooh.
So
for being disobedient to him, being disobedient to my husband.
Yeah.
So I got a serious spiritual spanking.
Mm.
So what I got.
So I will read this, and this is where Isaiah has a vision of the Lord. And it says here, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it," just picture this, close your eyes and picture this. I want to paint this one day, because this just must be a beautiful, glorious sight to behold. "Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one flew from the one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. So right there, send me. Isaiah said, send me. Yes. And the Lord said,
yes.
Verse 9, go and tell this people.
Yes.
Okay. Here's the part that broke me, because I read up to verse 8. Oh, send me, Lord. You want to send me out? Send me. I will go for you. And I'm like, why does it seem like I'm not really reaching people, Lord? You know? And, mm-hmm. and he said, mm-hmm. well, maybe you should finish reading. Says here, he said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert and be healed.
Amen.
They don't want to.
That's right.
They don't want to. And you know, as a matter of fact, God didn't want them to. In Isaiah, not in what we were doing. In Isaiah, God did not want them to. He was looking down upon a rebellious people.
Right.
They, all throughout the Old Testament, you saw the same thing. We repent, we tear down our idols, and, you know, get rid of Baal, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But we have not really given it all over to God. One generation, and then they're back. Another generation, and then they're back. And another generation, it's a repeated cycle. And at this point, I guarantee, you know, that the Lord was sick of this crap. Yeah, I said it. Crap. Okay?
Because back to my favorite book of the Bible, Ecclesiastes 1:11, there is no remembrance of former ones, nor is there any remembrance of those that are to come by those who come later on. We get comfortable. And when we get comfortable, what do? We forget it, God. But a little trivia fact, I guess, for people. If you want to read a book of the Bible, Isaiah. I mean, we're in Isaiah right now. Isaiah fascinates me. You know, there's 66 books in the Bible, right? There's 66 chapters in Isaiah. So there's 39 books in the Old Testament. And when you read Isaiah, the first 39 is the judgment to come. And in the book of Isaiah, it is the judgment to come. And then you take the last 27 chapters in Isaiah, it goes with the 27 chapters of the Hadashah, or the New Testament, or apostolic writings, whatever you want to call it, which is our deliverance. If you want to read one book in the Bible, read the book of Isaiah. Because that is the Bible summed mm-hmm. up mm-hmm. in one book.
It shows the Lord, and it shows the coming of the Messiah, and it shows yes. what everybody oh, yes. will go through. And it's yes. the thing is a lot of people look at the Bible, and yes, it's for us to learn and to understand, and it shows us our sin and looks at the law as our sin, and it shows us all this stuff. But actually, from Genesis to Revelation, it's about Jesus. It really is. Like, yes. everything kind of points us to Jesus. Even in Jeremiah, when, you know, Jeremiah probably didn't understand why the Lord told them to, right. you know, sit and buy this land for a certain amount. But that was showing that Jesus was sold for 30 pieces of silver. And so everything
the price of a slave.
The price of a
well,
slave.
Well, yeah, I mean, because at the end of the day, in the scriptures, you think you find eternal life. But the scriptures speak of who? The scriptures speak of Jesus, you know? Yeah. I mean, and scripture even tells us that. You search the scriptures for eternal life, but in the scriptures, it speaks of me.
Yes.
Jesus is, you know, the whole, from Genesis 1 to Revelation, I don't know the last verse of Revelation, I'm sorry, but in it is our Savior, and it speaks of
Yahweh. You know, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus is the Word. And when you read the Word, he's the Word. It's about him. And I find it to be kind of a strange marriage when you read the scripture. Like, so it's a love letter, and it seems like the Lord is pleading with his people to, you know, if you do it my way, wonderful things will happen to you. Yeah. And the land will be healed, and you'll have a land flowing with milk and honey, and, you know, you'll always, you won't suffer disease or anything if you follow my law. Because if you look at the Levitical law, it's pretty self-explanatory. You know, you're going, well, look at what Donald Trump said we should do, or look at what this doctor said we should do. Well, you know what? The Lord already said that in the book of Leviticus on what you should do to wash your hands and stuff to keep, you know. You know, and a lot of people will talk about, you know, being above the law when it comes to the food that you eat. Well, if you look at the food that the Lord is telling you not to eat, well, there's a reason for that. It's not good for you. Mm-hmm. These are scavenger animals. That's right. They're not good for you to eat. You know, like a dog, like, you know, there's a really big, in Asia, there's really big dog eating farms and stuff. But a dog, if I've watched my dog will eat out of the garbage, no problem, if he was given a chance. And it's probably not a good idea to eat a garbage eater. It's full of disease. Like a bear. We just had a bear not that long ago eat out of the big garbage can. They'll eat whatever.
He was a fair-sized bear, too.
And they're scavenger. And so when you look at the Lord, everything the Lord is telling you in the Word, about how you can have eternal life. It's about how to keep yourself, how he's going to keep you healthy, how to keep the land, you know, healed, how to, you know, keep from being tempted of the devil. You know, he already told you in Genesis how the devil tempted humans. So,
because it's not like Noah had garbage disposals and landfills.
Yeah.
What did they have? They had pigs to eat the trash. They had, you know, buzzards to eat the dead animals. It's not like you throw it in the back of a... It's not like, you know, it's not like Jeremiah could throw his dead deer or a dead, you know, animal in the back of a dump truck to take somewhere to get rid of. You know, God made things for a reason, and he told us. You know, it's just like I tell my kids, hey, don't drink that bleach. If you drink the bleach, you're going to get sick. Don't eat all this, because if you eat gummy bears for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, you're going to get sick.
Oh,
you
know?
What a way to go.
You know, like you messed up my whole night now. I want to eat some gummy bears. I want to be a gummy bear. I'm sorry, go ahead.
The only creatures on the earth that create waste are humans. Because if you were to look in the animal kingdom, if you look in nature, everything does. So if a wolf kills a deer, and the wolf pack will eat what they want, but then the coyotes and the eagles and other animals will come in and they'll eat the rest. You very rarely find bones of animals.
Unless it's left by man.
Unless it's left by man. Mm-hmm. So the only time you really see a skeleton is if a human hunter has killed said animal. They usually take what they want out of the animal, which is usually the meat. Some will take the skin, most will leave the fur and stuff, and they'll leave the bones. And we're the only ones that really create waste, and God created it that way. So when God's telling you, you know, don't eat a pig, well, that's because that pig
We'll eat.
I'm in the supermarket, I make people get disgusted because I'm like, you know, I'm looking at the beef, and then there's the pork is right there, and then there's the chicken. But as I go near the pork, I'm like, oh, swine. And they look at me. I go, that's what it is. It's swine. Ew. And I keep walking. I never thought about it that way.
No. You know what I never understood, and I've said this time and time again. Since we stopped eating pork, and that is quite simply, why would you want to eat an animal that Jesus cast demons into?
Oh, ouch.
Right.
I never thought about that one. That's a good one. That's right.
You know what? Let's talk about that for a minute, okay? How much smarter are pigs than us?
No, really.
Let's discuss it, okay? Okay. So there was a man who was possessed with many demons. Let's say the demons are called, I don't know, Legion. Yeah. Okay? Just the name I threw out there off the top of my scripture.
Good one.
the top of my scripture.
That's so good.
There's a man possessed with Legion. The point of the retelling of this event was not to know the man's name, because we don't. But we know the demon's name, because a legion is 10 to 15,000. That would be a legion
of soldiers. Like Anonymous, who says, we are many, we are legion.
Right. So we are legion because we are many. That's what the demon told Jesus, okay? This man lived in a cave for a long time, okay? Possessed.
Lived amongst the tombs.
Possessed with demons, okay? The swine were just doing what swine do. Jesus sent the demons into the herd of swine, and the first thing they did when they realized they were possessed is they went and drowned themselves.
Wow. How
about they got rid of what was wrong with them.
How about that?
Even if it meant the end of their life.
They're so very cute. I can't eat Wilbur.
But there's a man who was there. There's a man who was there amongst the tombs, amongst the dead, living with demons to keep him company. And he just sat there and did it. That was it.
Right.
He didn't care about the future.
Let's go back to Isaiah 66:17.
I love Isaiah.
They sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the gardens behind one tree in the midst, eating swine's flesh.
Don't they do that in Hollywood?
And the abomination and the mouse shall be consumed together, saith the Lord. So there's a lot, you know, and I've had this, you know, discussion with Christians about, you know, eating. Oh, well, you know what? I can eat my bacon. Really, you just don't want to give it up. Mm-hmm. You don't want to deny yourself. Mm-hmm. Deny yourself.
Try vegan bacon. It's so good. It tastes like pepperoni.
Beef bacon is the best. Oh.
Mm. Beef bacon is good. Yeah,
I know.
I love turkey pepperoni.
So expensive.
I mean, turkey pepperoni.
Oh, yeah. Turkey pepperoni, Aldi's. It's so cheap, too.
We don't have to give up. You know, and really, at the end of the day, I could eat a nice T-bone steak, or I could eat a pork chop. And they both taste good. But, you know, I remember what pork tastes like.
Pork
is good. But God has given me so many other things that I could eat that he has approved of.
Yeah.
Do I really need to eat a pork chop?
A swine chop.
Apart from the cost and apart from the taste, they have already scientifically proven that pork has little to no nutritional value.
Pork is actually like when people
doughboy bacon
go into
beef bacon doughboy. Come on.
when people go into medical school and stuff, they'll actually use
turkey
eggs
bacon. Chicken bacon
for their. They'll use the pigs for their cadavers and stuff because we're really close to, like, the flesh is really close to humans. So when they're practicing like their medical degrees or when you're practicing like archery or stuff like that, they use swine flesh because the flesh is pretty close to like human skin. So that kind of grossed me out because that just like seems more like a cannibalism or something. I was like, yuck! Like that airplane movie, that Alive or something. I never seen it, but I've seen.
You never seen that?
No, I've seen an ad for it, but I heard
Donner Party of Eight.
Yeah, I never seen it, but I don't like the idea. But I just went on this big thing with because I have a sister in the Lord on Facebook, and she is under serious attack for being. She's being told she's in sin because she's a vegan.
What
a joke!
And yeah, she was told that
that you're supposed to, you know, Jesus ate fish and Jesus ate lamb. And I said, well, Jesus actually probably only ate lamb once a year. Meat was very expensive back then.
And only rich people could afford to eat it on a regular basis. Yeah,
but, I mean, I said, you know, it's not a sin for you to eat the clean meat, you know. So mm-hmm. if you're going to eat venison or beef or chicken or whatever like that, lamb, that's fine. But it's also not a sin to be a vegan because before the flood, they pretty much were. They didn't eat meat. It was after the flood that they started eating meat. So it's not a sin. It's whether, like Paul said, it doesn't matter if you eat meat or don't eat meat.
Yeah. It's not a salvation issue. It's not a salvation issue. I'll say it like that. Go ahead.
And you know, that is a very interesting issue because a lot of modern day Christians who eat pork will throw that verse up, you know.
You know,
don't let nobody judge you in what you
eat. Don't let nobody judge us for not eating it.
But the thing is, if you put it in context, if you go a couple verses before it, a couple verses after it, that was actually the first argument between vegans and us carnivores, okay?
Yeah.
Because a lot of people wouldn't eat meat. No, seriously, because a lot of people wouldn't eat meat because, of course, it was, you know, they didn't know if it was offered to idols or anything like that. So you had a certain people who says, this is why you shouldn't eat meat at all. Now, when they're talking about meat, they're talking about clean animals, right?
Don't let no one judge you.
If you're a vegan, don't let them judge you. If you eat meat that is clean, don't let them judge you. And this is where Christians will say, see, this says right here, you know,
and
don't judge
careful.
Me for the meat
don't
that
eat,
I eat.
Don't
the
eat.
Thing is, right, the thing is,
no,
the
I was
meat
gonna say,
that
don't
all
eat
I'm talking
halal.
About is clean.
Don't eat halal food. It is
right.
forfeit
that
up
is
to Allah. Okay, don't eat anything that is
right.
forfeit up to another god. Don't
right.
eat halal, definitely.
Well, see,
right.
see Jason, so I got a lot of people because I decided to be a vegetarian. And it had nothing to do with salvation or anything. And Paul and had always said, well, you know, whatever conviction you have. And to
right.
be honest, being vegetarian actually has really helped Jason with the Crohn's. Because every time he eats meat, he would go into a bit of a flare. It doesn't matter
oh,
if it
wow.
was clean meat or not.
Okay.
It's just that, so when I took away, because he needs extra protein, but when I took away the meat from him and I gave him more plant-based protein, he feels better now.
Mm.
And it's
right.
not like, but with me, I can honestly tell you it wasn't, I mean, it was partially health, but it was more because bad things happen. I can't even touch pork, even spiritually or physically speaking. Pork just does bad things. But even chicken and turkey was doing bad things. So the only thing I could get away with
mm-hmm.
was red meat,
mm-hmm.
right? So what I did is, though, my conviction is could be different from yours, right? So my conviction is, the reason I became vegetarian is because I'm such an animal lover, I kind of looked at the animals, and then I kind of realized,
yeah,
well,
yeah.
look at that cute little face of that little cow sticking his tongue out. Well, the steak on my plate came from that little cow, you know? So that's my personal conviction.
I hear you.
You know, but if people want to eat meat, as long as it's clean meat, and I told my
right.
sister, the Lord, this, I said, if you're a vegetarian, that's fine. It's not a religion. She does it because she feels it's better health-wise for her. And
right.
and so she does it. But it's not a sin. And the people
right.
to tell you, you know, like when you're watching all these redneck TV shows and they're wandering around catching frogs and eating them, well, that's an unclean food, a frog.
Right.
Certain food was put on the planet to clean, okay? Shellfish cleans the bottom of the ocean. You know, pigs
right.
clean, you know, the farmlands or wherever they are. God created certain things for certain reasons. And, you know, but it's not a matter of salvation. Let's get back on sheep and goats.
Yes.
Like right. goats. Goats are used to clean up everything.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They
yeah.
really are. Like
yeah,
they'll eat everything. They'll, you know, if you want your land cleared,
You just bring in a few coats, they'll clear the land completely.
Oh, wow.
Like, they'll take out all the old rusty things, that nails and stuff that might be on the land. They'll take out the grass. They'll out the weeds. They'll take out... they take. That's all goats ever do.
You know what John just said? John just said, and Doughboy is John, Brother John. He just said, I work outside. Eating pork outside in the heat will make you sick. There's a reason for that. Yeah, there's a reason for that, that's for sure. You know, we just got to, you know, we want to obey God, you know, what he tells us to do. But it's not a salvation issue. There's some people out there that would tell you it's a salvation issue.
And that's what the goats do, is they take scripture and they trail mix it. Yes. And they take out what they like, and they skip what they don't like of it. And they'll say, okay, well, you know, they'll call some parts of God's word a metaphor, and then they'll call other parts of God's word truth. And it's like, well,
I take my
scripture literally. Mm-hmm. What God says is God says, and no matter which way you look at it, and you know, they'll do, like Jason was arguing with this person about the love gospel, and when he said that, you know, homosexuals are children of God, he said, well, you're loving them to hell, mm-hmm, because you're telling them that their sin is okay, and mm-hmm, you're not letting God change.
Everyone's created by God, but they are not children of God unless they repent and come to Jesus and obey him. Go ahead.
So it's Jesus that changes. It's the Holy Spirit that calls you. It's the Holy Spirit that changes the heart, mm-hmm, and cleanses you of the sin.
Right.
But I'm not going to lie and tell you it's not.
No.
Exactly. You know, I've always kind of believed in free will, so I get the idea they have to choose the Lord, and if they reject him, God doesn't send people to hell. They reject God, that's where they end up.
They send themselves there. Because
God can't be with sin. He's holy. So unless you're cleansed by the blood of the Lamb, and you have the blood on your doorpost, I'm sorry, hell is where you're going, and that's your choice. And when you see people posting, I bet you hell will be fabulous. Well, then I guess that's what you think. I never believed in the Catholic Church of the way they put their crusades, and they went and tried to force Muslims into Christianity or Christendom or whatever they called it, and they killed people if they didn't agree with them. I don't believe in conversion therapy where you force a homosexual to be non-homosexual.
You pray for them.
But I do believe, tell the truth.
Yeah, you show them love.
And I tell them, you know.
Look at Brother Victor Romero on Facebook. My Brother Victor Romero on Facebook, he was on the air. And I'll post his program one time. I mean, I know him about 10, 12 years ago, too. And he was a homosexual. He was married to another man for 20-something years. And Satan appeared to him, okay? He had demons in his apartment. And he cried out to the Lord. His testimony is so awesome. It really is. And he is just preaching the gospel now. So powerfully, that man is so powerful. I love you, Brother Victor. My goodness.
Well, I try and tell the goats this. You know, I always, because I know the difference. You know them by their fruit.
Yeah.
And you can pretty much tell. And I hate it when people say, oh, well, this person's a Christian. Well, their fruit says otherwise.
That's right.
Because their fruit is falling off the tree and it's rotting everywhere. Totally. So I believe their vine is rotting and it's not. So I'll look at the goats and I'll tell them, you know, one compromise, even one small compromise with the world will lead from one sin. If you look at a drug addict, or if you look at like a homosexual, if you look at somebody who's in a bad shape in the world, mm-hmm, and Christians will do that too. One small compromise, I can look at another woman because... You know, and look but don't touch, right?
Yeah.
Touch but don't taste. Well, what did taste Jesus but say? Don't enjoy. Mm-hmm. And that's what they do. And that's what the church does, is they'll do one little compromise. They'll say, okay, well, we're going to accept everybody, you know, so we're going to decide that a homosexual can be part of the children's ministry.
No way.
They'll take that
person will say, well, now that person could be a pastor. And one, and then the church will just fall.
Mm-hmm.
Because one little sin, mm-hmm. one little leaven leavens the whole lump. And when you bring one little sin in, you know, that's what happens to marriages. The husband or wife will look at one little sexual content on internet, and then it'll lead to a little bit of porn and a little bit of more porn, and then all of a sudden that spouse is committing adultery.
And the scripture says that if you even look on a woman with lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. Jesus said that. Okay, you've heard it been said. But I say, thou shalt not commit adultery, but I say if you've looked on a woman with lust, you've already committed adultery.
The goats are compromising.
Yes.
They want a little bit of Jesus from the word that they like. The nice Jesus that doesn't tell them they're hypocrites.
The happy hippie Jesus.
They want the happy hippie Jesus.
The cool guy upstairs.
Truth be told, if somebody was to actually look up the hippie movement, it wasn't the whole 1969 flower child thing that they say. The hippie movement was actually, the real hippie movement, was actually an anti-establishment, anti-government world, anti-war establishment, and they left the worldly stuff and they went into communes to do it a natural way. Now, whether it was like, you know, sometimes there were drugs, but there are still hippie communes today that have been around since the 60s and they live off-grid. Jesus would be considered back then, he was a rebel. He was anti-establishment, mm-hmm. anti-hypocritical religion. He was anti what the comfort of the world was. And he just told you like it was.
Mm-hmm.
So when people get offended if I say, well, I'm a hippie Christian, I am. I'm anti-world.
Uh-huh.
I'm pro-Jesus and I'm anti-world. I want nothing to do with what you have to offer me.
This whole world, just give me Jesus. I want to tell you guys what happens to real sheep. This is what happens to real sheep, okay? Let me tell you what happens. You want to know what happens to real sheep? Tell me. Ask me. Go ahead. What happens?
Hey, what happens to real sheep, Patricia?
What happens to real sheep? Let's take a look. I have a list of some real sheep here. What happened to them? You know, they were wealthy. They had everything that they could possibly know. These is Jesus' disciples. In 44 A.D., James was executed along with his executioner. See, his executioner loved the way James did it and his love for the Lord so much. And those of you out there that are saying Christianity is fake, well, most of it is. But the Bible is wrong? No, it's not, because I don't know about you, but I wouldn't die for a lie, okay? Here we go. Peter was crucified upside down in 64 A.D. because he didn't think he had the right to be crucified the way Jesus was. Andrew was hung from an olive tree in 70 A.D. Thomas was thrust through with pine spears in 70 A.D. Why did they do this if Jesus wasn't real? Okay. Philip was tortured and crucified in 54 A.D. Matthew, you know the book of Matthew, he was beheaded at Nadar in 60 to 70 A.D. It's between 60 and 70 A.D. Nathaniel was flayed and crucified. His skin was peeled from him. Hello? And then in 70 A.D., he was crucified. James the Lesser was beaten to death with a fuller's club in 63 A.D. You really want to become a born again? This is what you got to look forward to. Simon the Zealot, martyred in 74 A.D. Judas Thaddeus, beaten to death in 72 A.D. Matthias, stoned to death while hanging on a cross in 70 A.D. John was fried in boiling oil in 95 A.D. And Paul beheaded in Rome in 67 A.D. This is what happens if you follow Jesus. And it's going to happen. It's happening around the world.
And if you can't handle the fact that those were back then, let's look at now. Oh. There was a 5-year-old that was buried alive in Pakistan.
That's right.
A believer, because she refused to say that Jesus
was not God. She wanted to follow Jesus. She was 5 years old, buried alive, of course. You know, hallelujah, I'll give you some good news. She didn't die because Jesus, when they dug her up, she said they couldn't believe her mother and her little baby brother were dead. They were all buried alive too, all three of them. But the little five-year-old, they said, why are you alive? And she said, Jesus sat with me in that dirt the whole time.
Oh, Lord.
So she was willing to die. Nowadays in China, they will walk 8 hours. I mean, people complain about the pews in church. They will walk 8 hours in a storm to get a page of the Bible, and they will pray for 8 hours, and they will pray, and then they will walk 8 hours back to their village. And if they even have that page, they could be killed. In Egypt right now, Christians are being still crucified. Mm-hmm. There are still, you know, a pastor and his family were taken out in India, and they were beaten to death,
yes,
and their church burned, yes, down because they refused to say no to Jesus. They refused to recant, as mm-hmm. the Catholic Church mm-hmm. calls it. Mm-hmm. They refused anything. So right through history, from the apostles all the way up to now, You know, maybe the American Christians with their little goats and their little church buildings and their comfy pews and their coffee shops in the church or whatever, maybe they're not being persecuted, but guess what? We know
it's
as
coming.
The sheep who hear Jesus' voice, we know that Christianity is going to be illegal.
Oh, yes.
We know
oh,
that yes, the Antichrist coming. Is going to come into power, and we're ready.
Mm-hmm. So
bring it.
So
yes,
we
let's look at Acts 5. Okay, and Peter was just in front of the council, and they got beat. And when they left, Acts 5:41 says what? And they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer.
Yes,
shame for
worthy,
his
worthy, worthy.
That's
yes.
right.
Yes.
We've discussed this before, and I believe Patricia wanted me to bring it up again.
Mm-hmm.
What we see going on. The church, the body, the portion of the body that has the most power is the one that is the most persecuted. And that sounds strange, but let me explain to you why that is, okay? In the early church, during Paul's time in Rome, before he was beheaded, before Nero, the church, and even following that, the church was run like this. They went out to the highways and the byways. They preached the gospel in the face of persecution. They brought people back. Unbelievers. We'll call them agnostics. Those who were searching but did not know what they believed. Okay? They brought them back for the meetings. Okay? And during these meetings, they would be witnessed to by many. After these meetings, the unbelievers, the unborn again, the unsaved, were not allowed to come into a second meeting, where the true believers, the apostles, the etc., etc., got together and prayed, worshipped, and fellowshiped as God intended. Okay? In this day and age, we don't have the separation between, in the churches, between the sinners and the saints. We don't. We all sit together one
Which
with
is
another.
Why there's so much compromise, because they're so busy trying to bring the sinners to Christ that they're forgetting that the saints aren't learning anything.
That is correct. Now, In a society, even now, China, Iran, Pakistan,
Russia,
India, in these countries where Christianity is illegal and heavily persecuted, you will not have a goat sticking around.
You will not have an unbeliever in their meetings.
Because you do not have an unbeliever in their meetings, because
it's
the unbelievers are part of the world, and they fear the rest of the world. They fear
the repercussions from them even mentioning, even whispering the name of Jesus. Okay? Never mind anything else. Okay? So you have true born-again believers willing to do whatever is necessary to come together with other born-again believers, even in the face of persecution. Mm-hmm. The heavier the persecution, the more power the church has, because it is not tainted with unbelievers. In the West, in England, in Australia, in North America, in Canada, and several other countries, we have unbelievers sitting amongst believers. We have no persecution. And there has not been a widespread persecution as of right now in Canada. Well, North America, period. Okay? Because it's illegal, because churches are willing to compromise their preaching, they're willing to preach the government, not the scripture. They're willing to preach what the government tells them to preach, not what their supposed Lord and Savior tells them to preach. Mm-hmm. But I tell you, the time is coming, and it's coming quickly.
Yes.
When persecution is coming upon America, mm-hmm, and Canada.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it is coming really quickly.
Yes.
And this is where we will see the separation of the goats and the sheep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This is where we will see the church at its greatest.
Amen.
At its most influential. Because yes, all it took.
The true church. Was The true church. Yes.
Because sheep. All it took in Jesus' day, all it took was 12 men.
Mm-hmm. That's right. They turned the world upside down.
Absolutely. We see 5,000 being fed, which is a few loaves and a few fish. Okay? We see 5,000 being fed, and then Jesus preached.
Yes, yes.
And yes, most of the people went away.
It did take 12 men. It took the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're absolutely correct.
No, I'm sorry. But you are correct.
12 men. But 12 men full of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
That's correct. Yes. So we see 5,000 following Jesus. He provided for them. And then when he started preaching, they didn't like what he was preaching. And if memory serves me right, it was, if you want to be one of mine, you must eat of my flesh and drink of my blood.
And they all left him.
Mm-hmm. And they all left him. And then after, mm-hmm, his crucifixion, the sheep scattered. And it was foretold that it was going to happen.
That's right.
And then Jesus resurrected. And on the day of Pentecost, we had 120 people. He went from 5,000 followers to 120 in the upper room. And those 5,000, might I add, scripture is pretty specific, that was just the men. That did not include the women and children. You could probably multiply that by 3. Could you imagine feeding around 15,000 people, right, with just a few loaves and a few fish? Only God can do that.
Amen.
And as persecution mounted, we saw the church growing, not getting less.
We saw
Paul going from town to town. Excuse me, Saul going from town to town in a murderous rage, arresting people.
Get born again, get kicked off their high horse.
I think so.
That's what I pray for my oldest son, the one that said Bible should be free. He said, I pray that he gets a Damascus experience, that he gets kicked
right
off, yes, his high horse.
I prayed that for John also many a time. Yes.
Lord, you know? Yes.
So what we see is that during the greatest persecution, we see the greatest numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus had just been crucified, dead, buried, and resurrected. What was it? He stayed with them 40 days after he was resurrected,
mm-hmm,
and then it was another 40 days after that to the day of Pentecost.
Mm-hmm.
So less than 3 months, okay? Afterwards, there were 120 people in the upper room. The Holy Spirit fell about the place.
3,000 got added to their number.
And 3,000 got added to their number that day.
Miracles only followed the gospel.
The
word of God was preached, God added to their numbers, miracles happened. miracles are not happening. Everybody in the church, like you hear in charismatic churches and Pentecostal churches anyway, you hear them going, we want the next great awakening. We're going to get a great awakening. Their great awakening is going to be a shock because it's not what they're thinking. It's not thinking that the churches are going to fill up and all that stuff. It's going to be the separation of the sheep and the goat, the wheat and the tares. It's going to be that the great persecution and a great tribulation is coming upon them, and the remnant is going to be awakened. And the power of God is going to follow the remnant. That's the great awakening. That what they're all thinking with the whole, yay, everybody's going to be saved. And
you're right, they are talking about a great awakening, but they're going to get a rude awakening.
Oh, yeah.
What was it, 2,000 plus years ago, they were... they were looking for a lion, and they ended up getting a lamb. And now the churches are expecting a lamb,
mm-hmm.
and they're going to get a lion.
They still see Jesus in the manger. I don't see Jesus as a baby in the manger. I see Jesus as the Book of Revelation, where his eyes are on fire.
Hold on. Let me read that. I'm going there right now.
Why don't you read that, Jason? Come on.
Hey, well, I just want to mention, let's not forget John, who would, you know, cuddle Jesus at the Last Supper and lay it in his bosom, was also the same John when revealed in Revelation, fell in fear to the same Jesus.
Yeah.
That's right. So
keep us, Lord. Don't let us turn our backs on you. Please keep us, Father.
People are expecting this hippie in a dashiki Jesus, okay?
With blue eyes and long brown hair.
This is what people portray Jesus as.
Jesus is not even the Jesus that Peter and them saw.
No,
Caesar Bulgaria?
Yes,
that's who it is.
But anyway,
that ain't even the real Jesus.
So this is what they're expecting, but what they're gonna get is this: Revelation chapter 1. I'm going to read...
Are you in the Bible again?
Yeah, I know.
This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. This is the revelation...
That's right. This is the revelation of Jesus. It's not revelations. It's one revelation. It's not the revelation of John. It's the revelation of Jesus.
Amen.
Verse 9. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ... was in the isle that is called Patmos.
See, we're going to have to learn that patience and companions and brother in tribulation.
That's right.
I like to have brothers and sisters in tribulation.
So just to reiterate on what you read there, John was thrown into boiling oil, but the Lord delivered him out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And he was sent to the salt mines of the Isle of Patmos, where he lived out most of the rest of his days. He died naturally.
There was an awesome... Yeah, he did. We saw an awesome movie of him. The Revelation of Jesus Christ.
Isn't that an amazing
awesome
movie?
Awesome movie. We saw that last week. That's what we watched last week. No, that we saw Pilgrim's Progress last week. It was 4 weeks ago. It was my turn again. Family movie night. Every 4 weeks, every week we get a turn. But it was my turn.
Nice.
But that was an awesome movie. Oh, man.
So here he says he was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. He was persecuted and he was isolated. Okay? The Isle of Patmos was an isolation.
Mm-hmm.
Like maybe there were other people around, but there was an isolation there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, unto Smyrna, unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, unto Sardis, unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. Now check this out. Remember, they're waiting for a lamb.
Yeah.
They're waiting for like this beautiful, clear complexion, tall... Like, how many Jews are, like, tall as the Jesus portrayed?
None in my family.
I'm just saying.
Come on.
This is what was the amazing thing, is that God chose a nation that was short. I'm just saying.
When he was on. See, they're even expecting. If you picture what Peter was considered a big man, considering for a Jew, but the average Israelite was about 5'8". The men, and Jesus was probably. I mean, Scripture in Isaiah. Again, we go back to Isaiah. Said he was not much to look at. So when Peter and them met him on the Seas of Galilee and stuff, there was this uncomely, you know, common-looking man. But that's not even the Jesus now, because he is a king now.
So that's what they're expecting. They're expecting some portrayal of Jesus, but this is the Jesus they're going to have to stand before. Mm-hmm. All of us are going to have to stand before in the Day of Judgment. Just picture this. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned... Oh, wait, sorry. I got to skip ahead a little. Yeah, okay. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks was like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead.
That was a shock.
This is the Jesus that we're all going to have to stand before. This is a common misconception. Mm-hmm. I've preached on this. This commonly misconceived Jesus, okay? This Jesus, this love, like I said, this happy, hippie, you know, love, peace, and all this stuff. But Jesus said, I did not come to bring peace.
I came to bring the sword. Yeah.
Right. Okay? So this is the Jesus. This Jesus that, I don't know who this Jesus is who most of these churches are worshiping.
That's their American dream Jesus.
Yeah, I don't know this Jesus. The Jesus I know turns over temple tables.
Hello.
The Jesus I know sits down and braids a whip and drives money changers out. Okay? The Jesus I know preaches, blessed are the peacemakers. But he also preaches, blessed are they those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake.
The Jesus I know looks at the religious people and calls them snakes and hypocrites and
whitewashed
tombs. Mm-hmm. But then picks up the prostitute off the floor of a Pharisee says, daughter, your sins are forgiven.
Come on, that's
because
right.
She, like Jesus said, that's my favorite parable that Jesus does. He said there were two men that went into the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, one was a tax collector. The Pharisee said, I thank you, God, that I am not, you know, I give
10% of my, and blah, blah.
I thank you, God, I'm not like this tax collector over there. And the tax collector wouldn't even raise his eyes to heaven, and he beat his hands upon his chest and said, have mercy on me, Lord, a sinner. And it was the tax collector that went away right with God, justified. Not the Pharisee.
Yeah. That's right.
It's my favorite parable.
You know, the Jesus and the prostitute that I know.
That was turned down. Let's not forget the male was not turned down with her.
And
that's according
correct.
To the Mosaic law, both parties should have been put to death that day.
That's right.
And then but they was trying to trap Jesus. And,
yep.
You know.
So the continuing on here,
let me jump in. And Jesus told her, go and sin no more.
Amen.
That's right.
Yeah. Get rid of your greasy grace. Jesus wants us to go and sin no more. When I got saved back on July 27th, 1985 at 7:30 in the morning, he told me to go and sin no more. Now, do you mess up once in a while? Yeah, you do. You better repent right away. But I'm talking, I'm not going back to whoring around. I'm not going back to dealing drugs. I'm not going back to smoking dope, drinking down whole bottles of Snowy, and chewing down Quaaludes. I'm not doing that no more, okay? I'm not continuing in sin that grace may abound. I want to remain a sheep.
And the devil will come in. He only tempts you with what is known to you. There's no way the devil can come in and tempt me to do meth, because I've never done meth. Mm-hmm. But the devil can come in and tempt me with Wicca. He can. He'll tempt me with what I used to do.
And this is where I think the Lord tests me on a few things. So when tragedy used to happen before I was born again, first thing I ran to was a bottle. When my son passed away last year, the first thing that popped into my head, instead of why God, the first thing that popped into my head when I got the news, other than why God, was I need a drink. Yep, but then instead, the Lord pushed me and said, you know what, my daughter, call your sister. So I called you, Patricia.
I remember that.
You know, and this is where the Lord tests me. He'll test you with some of the temptations the devil puts at you. So because I was Wiccan, I worship the creation. And because I'm an environmentalist now, the Lord will test me to see if I will worship him and just be a good steward, or if I will go back to where I'm worshiping creation. And it's a very big test that I fight. But that doesn't seem to do that to Jason.
So what it ultimately comes down to with temptation is you cannot be tempted with something you hate.
That's good.
That's what I'm saying.
Sorry, that's what I was saying. So what it comes down to is I was a meth addict for years. And having been born again, I'm, and after a period of time, the Lord said, I know, my son, that you are ready. Go to the meth addicts. Go to the drug addicts.
Come on.
And I hate meth. I hate heroin. I hate drugs. And because I hate them with a vehement passion.
If I could
snap my finger and get rid of them all, I would. I hate them so much. And I hate them so much that I had dealers walk by me on the street and ask if I wanted to buy any.
Come on.
Do I really look like the kind of guy anymore that would do that stuff?
Talk about judging me based
on how I look.
Oh, that's a big one for me too. As a Wiccan, and I was Wiccan, I practiced all the holy days of Wicca. And
it was annoying, actually.
One thing I hate the most, and it really irks me with the goats of the church, is Halloween.
Oh, boy, yeah.
Halloween is one that really gets me.
Great program on that.
To Wiccas, Halloween.
Christmas and Easter is just as bad, though. Wiccans will tell you that
Christmas is a Christian holiday. They will. Because Wiccans celebrate. Actually, it's from the December 26th to January 8th, I think it is. It's a 2-week. It's called Yuletide.
That's right.
And they'll say Easter is a Christian thing, too. The one thing, the holiest day of the year for Wiccans is
Halloween.
It's Samhain is what they call it. Mm-hmm. It's All Hallows Eve. It is the most holy day, and I hate it so much that it really, really irks me when church people celebrate trick-or-treating and they celebrate Halloween and they say Happy Halloween, and I'm like, are you kidding?
So
Jesus saved me from the gods and God. Do you know what God you're worshiping when you are celebrating Halloween?
So the Lord...
A pumpkin on your door is so that the druids knew that you had already sacrificed your children unto the gods. The goddesses.
Yeah.
But as far as temptation goes, I'm going to go straight to scripture here real quick. James, let's go to James. James 1:12. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. And here's the key. James 1:13. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man.
Yes.
Here's the kicker. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust.
That's right.
You're tempted you sin because you want to fulfill the lust of your flesh. And you want to fulfill the lust of your flesh because in the back of your mind, you're really saying, Jesus Christ is not enough for
me. Preach it, Shane.
I need something else.
Come on, Shane.
There's sin for you. That's why you sin.
That's right.
Every man is tempted by the lust of his own flesh.
Start crucifying.
That's why we are to walk in the spirit and not walk in the flesh.
And you will not fulfill.
In the spirit, you will not. There's no condemnation now for those who are in the Lord Jesus Christ, but that's if you're walking in the spirit, because if you're walking in the spirit, then you are in the Lord Jesus Christ.
And it says if you walk in the spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh, because you are dead. A crucified man is dead to his sins. Okay, the dead man doesn't keep on going to where he was delivered from. Okay, you gotta read. Don't just read John 3:16. Don't read just John 3:16. Read the whole thing. Come on. Let's go there. I want to go there. Let me go there. We're going to read, For God so loved the world. He loves us all. He loves us so much. Yes, he does. For God so loved, E-D, that's past tense. He loved us so much back then that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Let's continue. Verse 17. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they may are wrought in God. So don't just stop at John 3:16. He loved past tense. He loved us that much that he went and did that. But if you decide right now, as you're listening, that you don't care, that you don't want to be bothered, then you have decided what you want to do. You love your darkness more than you love the light. And let me tell you, you're going to hear, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, into the lake of fire one day. We don't want you to do that. You know, I see some people yelling on Facebook on a post to somebody, a brother that I love. And I went, and everybody was coming against him. He didn't know the Lord. So everybody, I'm like, I started witnessing to him. Why are you coming against him? He doesn't know any better. And he started calling me names. So instead of me saying, well, the heck with you, I gave him a heart. He said something else. I gave him another heart. I'm not going to yell at him. I'm going to give him the word of God. And I'm going to let the Holy Spirit deal with him. That's what we do.
Mm-hmm. Right. And if you go back to John 3:18, I mean, let's go back to John 3:18. Let's break this down. It says, he that believeth on him is not condemned. Here's the thing. But he that believeth not is condemned already. So that means that the world, since the fall of the world back in Genesis, the world is condemned already. Mm-hmm. We are condemned. Mm-hmm. That's why we need redemption.
Mm-hmm. We were.
Here's the bad news. The bad news is we're all headed to hell. That's the bad news, because we have all sinned and all, you know, no one.
All have fallen short of glory of God.
Right. So we have been condemned already. But here's the good news. We have a Redeemer.
That's right.
We have redemption. Only in the blood of Yeshua, Jesus the Christ, do we have redemption, for there's no other name under the sun that man could be saved but by Jesus Christ alone. So, you're either condemned, or you are saved and born again. You have to be born again. Uh-huh. How do you get born again? Fall on your knees and repent. And they know, okay, I go to church, no, let's cry out to our Father.
But Shane,
and repent.
But Shane, I believe in Jesus.
Yeah, now you're on demon level.
Even the demons believe in Jesus, are they saying?
And tremble, yeah.
That's right.
Yes, right, exactly.
Let me go here now.
How'd that work out for them?
Let me go here now, and then you guys jump in after I read this one. Romans 6:1. Right. Here's what we hear all the time. Oh, I'm saved by grace. Let me read it. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin, live any longer therein?
Know you not that so many of us that were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death. You need to be baptized, water baptized. That like as Christ has raised us from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. So knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin may be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. And the next verse, for he that is dead is freed from sin. So stop using grace as an excuse to sin, okay? Stop sinning. If you're truly crucified with him, if you've been baptized and raised from the dead, okay, then you are dead to sin. So stop it. Crucify it. Sin is a decision. Stop deciding to watch porn. Stop deciding to get high. Stop deciding to fool around all over the place. Oh, it's Friday night. It's time to go drinking out. It's time to go hang out and have a good old time. No, it's the Sabbath of the Lord at Friday night. And why do you think that that's been perverted? The Sabbath of the Lord has been perverted. People go out and party their brains out tonight. But you're supposed to be, it's a separation. It's a time to get back to the beginning. Okay, if you've done something wrong you shouldn't have done during the week, repent. Repent at the moment you do it, but this is the time to get closer to the Lord. Spend the day in the Word of God. You know, if you've got to go do something, go pull a donkey out of a ditch. You know, somebody needs an old person that needs their lawn cut or something. It's not. You can turn a page, okay? Talmud says you can't turn a page. You can't talk. You can't do this. You can't do that. No, the Word of God says we're just not supposed to make, you know, put out love towards making money. Okay?
That's what grace means.
Yes.
Grace means
don't kill your chicken if it lays an egg. Do not go kill your chicken if it lays an egg on a Sabbath, but instead take that egg on a Sabbath and go feed somebody who's hungry.
Hello.
That's right.
And let's go to Romans. And you know what, sister, you're in Romans talking about that. So let's stay in Romans. Romans 8:12, where it says, therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. Mm-hmm. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. And that's what it comes down to. Who's your father?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Let's do a pop quiz here, okay?
Okay.
Not you. You don't pout at me, honey. You don't get to partake in this one. This is for Patricia and Shane only.
Uh-oh.
Let's see who could spit this scripture out.
Uh-oh.
I don't want you looking it up because I know you both know it. I want to hear the whole scripture.
Why are you looking at me then?
You've already mentioned it. About 10 minutes ago. Okay. Everybody ready?
I'm going to try.
Yes.
I'm going to give you the scripture reference, and I want to hear it in its entirety, not in its perverted state from, like, the Reviled Substandard Perversion or the New Illuminati Version. Okay? Okay, from the King James. Romans 8:1.
Okay. I can't remember.
Let's hear it.
What shall we say? No.
I've already said it. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in the Lord Jesus Christ.
There you go. That has to be.
That's not the whole scripture, brother.
Therefore is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus who walk not after the flesh,
but after the Spirit.
And the churches always forget the second
part. No, they don't forget it. They're reading a perversion.
Yeah.
Which has omitted the last part, who walk not after the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So what they say is there is no condemnation. If you say you're in Christ Jesus, you're not condemned. There is no problem. You don't have to worry about it.
The NIV is
grace all you want.
They don't realize that grace means unmerited favor, which means if you make a mistake, Jesus is just to forgive you if you repent, and he will show you that grace. So if you make a mistake and you get convicted, Like I said, I have a personal conviction about eating animals. So I would say about a week ago, I decided I really craved a steak. So I went and had a steak.
It was good.
But my heart was convicted of that. So I went to the Lord about that, and that's where my forgiveness came from. That's where the grace came from.
So we
but read, that's a personal conviction right between me and him.
And we read where
that's where grace comes in.
Maybe somebody can help me with that. If it is a sin to you to eat meat, right?
If you feel it's a sin, it's anything not done in faith. So if you didn't eat that meat in faith, then I guess that would be considered a sin.
Potentially. A sin would actually be much better defined as going against God's word.
Well, see, I'll let John define what sin is. Where John says sin is the transgression of the law, for he who transgresses the law sins.
Right. That's right. Which the law, which the law would have been handed down from God, which would be God's word. Actually, it would have been written by God's hand.
But... Yes. Yes, but Paul does say that if a person who doesn't eat meat feels it's convicted about eating meat, then the person who does eat meat shouldn't be eating meat in front of that person. And same with the person who doesn't eat meat, shouldn't be forcing somebody.
In other words, if you get invited to a vegan potluck,
Don't bring
a roast.
Yeah, don't bring a pot roast, right?
Yeah. That's just rude.
Okay, guys. All right, we're going on nearly 3 hours here. And this old lady's
this
trying.
Well, then.
We're nearly there.
Any closing things? Any closing things? Come on.
I haven't even started my closing
argument.
I
like to close with one thing.
What?
You might not get goat, and of course, goats... You know, goats jump fence. Goats are aggressive. Goats are never happy. Goats are never, you know, happy in their situation. So,
that's it.
But
they're
if you
carrots.
Don't know if you're a goat, if you think you are a sheep, again, my plea to you is, okay, so you're not a goat, you're a sheep.
Okay.
But who is your shepherd?
Who is your shepherd?
Regardless.
That's right.
Who is your shepherd?
That's right. And that means you're not supposed to have idols if Jesus, Yeshua, is
right.
Your shepherd. So get rid of the idols.
And this is the whole thing. And this goes with anything that we tend to talk about here. If you are unsure if you are walking in Christ completely, because 90%, heck, 99% obedience is still disobedience.
That's right. That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Yeah.
If you are unsure, just follow what the scripture says.
Mm-hmm.
Ask, seek, and knock.
And knock. That's
okay?
right. Let's
that's
pray.
It.
Then let's pray. Let's pray. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We bless
you.
Your holy name. Oh, Lord God. Golly, Father. This has been... Thank you for the strength to have gone this far. I thank you for that. Personally, I do. So much knowledge has come out. And I love this tag teaming with your scripture. I just love it. Because I know that this team loves you. And I just keep asking that you keep on drawing us closer and closer to you. So you can use us mightily, Father. Because without you in our lives, we won't be used. We can't be used. You want to use us. You want to use everyone is called to be a watchman, to watch and to pray.
That's right.
Before these things come upon us. So we ask, Father God, that if anyone is listening and they're not sure if they're a sheep, that they would go to you tonight and repent. If you're wondering if you've lost your salvation, that's a good thing. Because if you've been turned over, you wouldn't even think about it. So go to God.
That's
go
right.
to him right now and repent and ask him to cleanse you.
Yes.
And then get rid of anything that's in your home that's not of him. If you have any paraphernalia, yes. if you have any dirty books, movies, whatever. If you've got to get rid of your internet for a while to stop sinning, turn off your internet. I'm serious. You might have to do that.
Yes.
But what is your soul worth? Your soul is worth so much more than the internet being on. That's for
right.
sure. And we just ask that you would just
far better.
Cry out to him. Go ahead and pray. Go ahead and pray. Thank you, Father.
It'd be far better for you
yes.
to pluck your eye out or cut your hand off
Come on.
And cast it away from you.
Yes.
That
yes.
thing causes you to sin. It'd be far better yes. for you to get rid of it. If it is precious to you, how much more precious is your very soul?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
How much precious is eternity to you?
Thank you, Lord.
Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy, and we ask that you reach out and project this message, so to speak.
Yes, just
get it out there to those who need to hear it. Lord, if but for one. I'm believing for more, but if but for one, Lord,
this
almost 3 hours was totally worth it, Lord.
Yes, it
just
was.
Just to be able
yes,
to see what you have put upon our heart.
Yes,
Father. Lord, even if we're just prophesying to the wind, so be it. But Lord, your word never returns void.
No, it doesn't.
Father, let it go out.
Yes, Father.
Even if we don't hear about it until we enter eternity, Lord, let it go out in Jesus' name. Let it go out in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, I'm sorry. Go ahead, sister.
Thank you, Father, that you left the 99, Lord, to go
yes.
after that one.
Yes.
Whoever that one may be right now, that you've left us 99
yes.
because we know that you're the good shepherd. We know and we hear your voice that you go after that one lost sheep to bring them back to the flock, like Brother Shane said, that you, as the good shepherd, will take that one lost broken sheep and cuddle them.
Yes.
I think it was Shane that said that.
Yes.
Yeah.
That you would cuddle them up to your heart, and they
yes.
can hear your heartbeat, and you will bring them when they are strong enough back to the flock with us
yes.
99 that know your voice, Lord.
Yes.
And we
yes,
thank
Lord.
You
thank
that
Hallelujah.
You are the good shepherd. We
Hallelujah.
Thank you that you love us, and that we can hear your voice, and that you speak to us as only the good shepherd, that we know that any other shepherds that are out there in this world that are trying to whisper in our ears, we know, and we will not follow, because we know your voice.
That's right, Lord.
Thank you,
Father. Father, I just ask that whoever's listening to this right now, and for everybody, just turn their heart of stone to a heart of flesh.
Yes.
Make their heart just fertile soil for the seeds that you have planted tonight. For we have done nothing but speak your word.
Yes.
For it isn't about us. Father,
That's right.
this is all you for your glory,
you.
Father. I just ask that you open eyes and open ears and just make our hearts so fertile for the seed of your word. B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach.
Amen. Thank you,
Shabbat
Jesus.
Shalom. We
yeah.
love you out there.
Shabbat Shalom.
Amen.
Good night.
Good night.
Jesus, you can have this Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. Give me Jesus.